Adelaide and Glenelg. Joining me is Rick Davies. And just quickly,
you'd be happy, Kimber.
That was a big effort by the young boys, wasn't it?
Oh, they were fantastic after half time. They did not have a loser, did they?
Yes, and I think that'd stand Bruce Winter in pretty good stead for the job with the Eagles next year. Well, the big game, as I said, is between Port Adelaide and Glenelg. Let's go down into the Port locker rooms. And old Jack, he's a master of getting his boys up at the right time.
He certainly is. And have a look, there's Abernathy. Will he play his last game today? Jack, well, he's been here, done it before, hasn't he? He's just waiting to bounce the first ball. There's no question about that. And the players, they know what to expect. And I heard something last night. You never pick against Port in a grand final.
Well, they've played Glenelg on five occasions, and Glenelg have only won one. That was back in 1934. The last time they met was in 1990, and Port Adelaide won that one. As we take a look at the Port Adelaide lineup, and pretty awesome with Hodges at the top.
Well, I think that he's the key. I think that if Hodges can get on top today, but Paul Rouveray's been doing very, very well. Darren Smith, of course, Buckley, Magarey medalist. What can you say?
Yeah, got some fantastic players there, and Greg Phillips may be playing his last game. Well, Ian Day spoke to coach of Port Adelaide, John Cahill, a little earlier.
John Cahill, it's been an ideal preparation for Port Adelaide.
It has, Ian. You know, we've had good rest. We won our second semi-final. We did well. We settled down. We had no injuries. So we really hit this game 100% fit.
It's pretty windy out there. Is this an important toss to win?
Yes, I think it is, but just in case the wind changes, that's the only unfortunate part about football is windy, and it just throws a little bit of luck into the game. If I had a choice, I prefer it not to be windy, but that can't be helped.
You will obviously kick with it if you win the toss.
Oh, yes, yes, no doubt.
Right, John, you raised a few eyebrows during the week when your comments on John Fidge. Could that be counterproductive?
No, I don't see why I should have raised eyebrows. I mean, my opinion was that I thought more credit should have been given to guys like Marshall, Manswell, guys like that further up the field. John Fidge played very well. He's a good player. Now, you know, if they want to misinterpret that, if they got, if that's all they're worried about, they should be worried more about football than worrying about my opinion of some players. I didn't think that he trained very hard, and if Kim Hodgman was dead set honest, I mean, he would say the same that week. But I respect John Fidge as a full forward. There's no doubt about that. And what I said, I thought that more players should have got more credit rather than John Fidge that day. John Fidge did well, he kicked 11 goals, but I would say six of those would have been given to him on a plate.
John, good luck this afternoon.
Thanks a lot, Ian.
It's going to be a big game. He's very clever, John Cahill, the way he picks his words.
He respects him, but not much.
We'll see, Jumbo. Okay, we'll take a break and we'll have a look at the Glenelg lineup after that. It's Grand Final Day 1992. There's a big crowd, the weather's fine, and Port Adelaide, they meet Glenelg. We'll take a look at their lineup.
Just a touch windy, though, isn't it, Kim?
Yeah, a little bit, but not too bad, and I don't think that'll bother too many of the players today.
Well, of course, I think Jamison, he'll be up forward. Murphy, Lamb, they've got a number of players that can kick goals, and of course, without Fidge.
I wouldn't be surprised. Lyndon Bowe's named on the wing. I wouldn't be surprised if he started on the centre on Nathan Buckley and David Marshall perhaps went to the wing.
Yes, I suppose that could be the go. A lot of people are thinking about Buckley, though, won't they?
Well, Kim Hodgman, the coach of Glenelg, he knows where he's placed his players, but he won't be telling us, but Neville Roberts talked to him anyhow.
Kim, thanks for your time. How are the nerves?
It's pretty good. Yeah. I mean, obviously, it's exciting time of the year, and yeah, I feel pretty good.
You've got very few injuries, you've had a pretty tough preparation. How was selection? Straightforward or some difficult ones?
Obviously, it's always going to be difficult this time of the year, and obviously, you know, people know that Mark Russell's not playing today, so that was a very difficult decision. He played 22 league games this year, so bad luck for him, it's good luck for Gemma.
A lot of talk about Port Adelaide having slow legs and so on, and age, but you'd be the last person to be fooled by that talk.
Oh, there's no doubt about that. I mean, you can never overestimate your opponent, but you can never underestimate them, and they're proven finals players, and you know, they wouldn't be here unless they were, you know, good players.
In my opinion, I think your strike power is where maybe the trophy lies for you. How do you see it?
Oh, there's no doubt about that. I mean, we run the ball well out of our defence, and obviously we've got some key forwards. And I mean, obviously John Fidge is a key for us, but we've obviously got other players that can find the ball and kick goals for us. So if they concentrate on Fidge only, well, we may kick a few more goals.
Thanks for your time. We really appreciate it on Grand Final Day. Good luck.
Thank you, Neville.
As we take a look at the umpires coming out on the ground, the men in white officiating today, Kevin Chambers on the top left, flanked by Michael Abbott on the right. And we see the statistics on the two umpires. They had the prelim final last week, Rick, and they did an admirable job.
Yes, they certainly, I think they're the best two umpires as the base. Wouldn't it be a thrill for the young bloke there?
Yes, it would be, and have a look at that. The Tigers about to come out, and Quite unbelievable. The last time these two sides met was in 1990 in the grand final. Graham Corns was coach. It's history now. Port Adelaide won the game, and Corns was quoted as saying that is the last time that the Port Adelaide Football Club will beat Glenelg in a grand final.
Well, Kimmy Hodgman's been pretty forthright this week, hasn't he? You never ever consider yourself as a coach or a team unless you've beaten Port Adelaide in a grand final. And,
I agree with that, by the way.
An enormous day for Kim Hodgman. His second year of coaching. Last year he had enormous problems. He didn't get his side into the finals. This year he was under pressure mid-season, but he's just battled away like he did as a player. He's got them there.
It's amazing. They still don't like him, and here he is in the grand final. They thought they should have won more throughout the year.
Well, when you say they still don't like him, perhaps you should qualify that. There are rumours that perhaps he would be replaced as a coach. As we look at Port Adelaide about to come out, George Fiaci, the little man at the front, he was the Jack Oatey medalist in the 1990 grand final. Big Coochie Phillips, the captain of Port Adelaide. Marvellous atmosphere here at the moment. They are a mean machine, Port Adelaide.
And the crowd, of course, here to see a great game of football. It'll be hard and tough. I think you'll find that Port Adelaide, over the years, they've had a sort of a pretty rough house affair, but they're skillful players. And it was interesting to hear Mark Williams last night saying, I asked him about Mark Buckley, and he said young Wanganine was a better player, which really shocked me.
Actually, yes, Wanganine kicked, I think, something like one goal or two goals in the 1990 grand final, and a very talented player, and he's an All-Australian this year, so it's a fair comment, but I don't think there's much between them as youngsters.
No, I certainly don't, and I think you'll find that the game... OK, Johnny Cale just mentioned the bit of win. I think you'll find the toss is going to be pretty important, Kim, although the Eagles didn't win it in the reserves.
And do you think we'll see any surprises? There's been talk around town. It's been mooted that perhaps Danny Hughes will line up on fullback and a bit of a page back job on John Fidge, or you think that's just part of the hype prior to a grand final?
I think you'll find Johnny Fidge can handle anything that comes his way.
Fair point. We'll take a break and we'll come back with the 1992 grand final. The pre-match entertainment has started here at Football Park with the South Australian group Up for Grabs performing, and they'll be joined shortly by Australian jazz genius James Morrison.
Please let me explain. By mere bestuchan means you're grand. By mere bestuchan, now that I've explained, just kiss me and say you'll understand.
Something you got,
yeah.
Bring me home every day. Something you got.
Yeah.
Make me feel okay. Something you got. Oh, you wanna know. Whoa, 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 whoa. My, oh, my.
Whoa, whoa.
I love you so.
I love you so.
Something you got. Yeah. Bring me home every night. Feel all right.
Let me show you how,
yeah.
Heaven can
something
be.
You got.
Oh,
oh, you wanna know. Whoa, 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 whoa. My, oh, my. Whoa, whoa. My, oh, my. Whoa, whoa. My, oh, my.
Whoa, whoa.
I love you so.
I love you so.
Join up the grabs on stage right now. We present to you Australia's premier jazz musician. Would you please put your hands together for the fabulous Mr. James Morrison.
Went out and grabbed it and banned. And now the company jumps beneath his reveling.
He's a boogie boogie bugle boy from any pain. A two, giada two, goes a date to the bar. I'm a boogie rhythm. Bass and guitar is playing. And the company jumps when he plays Reveille. He's the boogie boogie bugle boy of company P.
And there's the high shot from our chopper, and Football Park looking magnificent as it does every October around Grand Final Day. And I tell you what, James Morrison, he can make that trumpet talk.
Oh, certainly can. I'm not a great, you know, trumpet player myself, but it looks like it's blown all his hair off his head, too.
Oh, dear, Rick, we knew you weren't a good trumpet player. Well, the scene is set. He does this every year. It should be a marvellous game. The toss has been won, incidentally, by Scott Salisbury. He is elected to kick right of screen, so that is to the southern end of Football Park, commonly known as the Golf Course End, and that is always referred to as the Golf Course End by Ian Day, who is our commentator today and a golfing fanatic. And it's going to be important for Glenelg to get off to a good start.
Yes, it certainly is. And you can see the Port Adelaide just getting their last-minute instructions. Glenelg coming in. They'd have to have a real chance, Kim, wouldn't they? I'm going for the Bays personally, but, you never pick against Port, I know.
Yeah, that's very true. I think man for man, they're as good as Port Adelaide. Port Adelaide are just conditioned to winning, though, and it's going to be a very, very tough game. The scene is now well and truly set. A marvellous effort there by Carol Carpenter and James Morrison, and there are 40-odd thousand people joining into the national anthem.
And they certainly enjoyed it too, Kimbo, and best of luck to both sides.
Yes, fair comment. Well, it's time to get the game underway. Our special comments gentlemen today will be Neville Roberts, former West Torrens, Richmond and Norwood champion, and to pick up the call of the game is the doyen of commentators, former South Adelaide Rover, Ian Day.
Thank you, Kim. Good afternoon, everybody. Grand final day in Adelaide, 1992. A huge crowd, standing room only, although at the back of the, I thought it was supposed to be a standing room only, at the back of the goalpost, there's quite a few seats vacant, which is unusual, Neville. But I thought they were all sold out.
Well, only a few seats left, Ian, and it's a pretty good crowd, in excess of 40,000 at least here at Football Park today.
Since 1969, since Glenelg became a power, they've played in 13 grand finals. They've won 3 and lost 10. And Port Adelaide, in their last 8 grand final appearances, have won 7 and lost 1. So there is maybe an omen. Is it the last man for the Port Adelaide captain, Man Mountain Greg Phillips?
Well, a lot of people say you'll be able to exploit his age and legs, but I can tell you one thing about Greg Phillips. He's never where the ball ain't. He reads it beautifully. He won't go on a decoy. And talking about older players, Scott Salisbury in vision now, his last game today, and he is the toughest player in South Australian football currently.
The breeze is blowing left to right. Scotty Salisbury's won the toss, kicking towards the golf course end. The flags are a flutter, although he didn't prove that in the reserves grand final. They scored quite easily at the lake end, so hopefully the wind won't play a big factor in this afternoon's result. Umpire Kevin Chambers in his first game, or first grand final, about to get it underway. Umpire Kevin Chambers holds the ball aloft to get the 1992 grand final underway. Down it goes in front of a crowd of 40,000 people plus. Christie against Chalmers. In there quickly as Buckley now thumps it out towards Hutton. Centre wing, Port Adelaide to go into attack now to the lake end, getting back on it. A top mark taken by Robbie Thompson.
A great start by the Magpies. There were 3 or 4 around that ball then when they took it forward through Hutton.
Kick up towards the half-back line. Fine mark, Murphy. Murphy now from centre wing to send the Bays into attack. Fidge is leading towards the pocket. There's 2-on-1 back there. Chalmers has dropped back in tandem with Delaney. Murphy puts it up high. Chalmers is going to get the leap, can't bring it down. Mansell through, Hallahan, Bow jams it onto his foot. The umpire's seen a free kick. Umpire Michael Abbott, and the free kick would go the way of Glenelg's Lyndon Bow. Now, wind assisted, he could almost make the distance, although he's 55 metres out. He's in Campbell's pocket, which is not an easy one. The graveyard of full forwards should take the left goalpost. Kick is going to be marginally short. Fidge is sandwiched between two. Mansell had a big swing. Oh, he's got it! Oh, he had an airy, then he butted up again, and the Bays are on the board.
Well, 2 attempts, and probably shouldn't have had that much time, but finally asking there with his hands whether he wants to change or stay on the ball, and got the message that there'd be a switch there. That's what he was saying. Have a look at it. One. Again, stayed with him. A little bit of fortune there for Mansell, but he made his own luck, and that is a dream start for Kim Hodgman, a dream start for the Tigers. Only a minute into the game, and they've scored.
Back centre field, Glenelg 1 goal, Port Adelaide yet to get on the board. As Christie gets the tap down, it's a good hit. It goes out towards Rubinick. He's dispossessed. Strong tackle there by Marshall. In there working hard is Williams, but it's a dead heat situation. And umpire Kevin Chambers will bounce very close to that centre circle once more. He's officiating with Michael Abbott this afternoon. Great atmosphere here at Football Park. You're on Nine's Wide World of Sports as the ball socket off the ground. Out to Chig Whedon. Chiggy jams it on the boot. Fidge is there. Delaney wins that battle. The ball goes down towards Jennifer. Rowan Smith playing on the wing. Gets it out to Rosonico. Puts it up high. The breeze says thanks very much and nearly pushes it back the other way as Foster stands his ground, as you should in a grand final, and takes a good mark. The handball to Jennifer. He'll have to be quick. He finds Chalmers, who's dispossessed by Christie. Play on the call. Jammo went off the ground. Not a fair. Effectively, Jennifer takes it. He's a bustling, hard-working player. He puts it out to Delaney. Fiacci, there's that combination. We'll see that again today. Over to Buckley, the Magarey medalist. Gets a handball. In turn, it goes to Foster. Back to Jennifer. Back to Foster. Too slow. Great tackle, Mansell. Well, oh, there's some desperation early.
And the only contentious point about this grand final from Glenelg's point of view, in my opinion, was their ability to match Port physically for four quarters. And that will be the real test for them. They've started brilliantly here.
More than half the players are in screen. The tension's on. Thompson gets a wild kick that it finds Rubinick, who is preferred to Mark Russell in the team. Chips it out now to Jamison. Well, maybe he was the player that was preferred to Mark Russell. Certainly the player that's coming in gives Chig Whedon the run. On the outer side, Foster won't get there. Gets a good sit. Fidge on the lead, short, won't quite get there. The kick was never online, and it goes out of bounds in the full forward left pocket with the Bays in attack. The Bays by 6 points. Huge crowd here at Football Park. 40,000 plus at the throw-in, about 35 metres around. Chalmers. Murphy will go with him. Murphy, Chalmers, Foster. Couldn't get rid of it. Chigwin gets it back. Hallahan puts it in towards Fidge, but this time it's Delaney in front, and he takes the defensive mark.
It's two out of two to Delaney, but that may come unstuck. That was an awful kick, and it is very rare we'll see Delaney make a mistake like that.
Well, they always like to switch the play, and that's exactly what Fiachi was trying to do, but into the breeze, rushing your kick. A bad mistake by Delaney. He has one Mansell, Kim, and he's well within distance here.
Tough pocket, really shouldn't be a problem. And it's... did that swing away? That's a point. And that just goes to show how strong that breeze is down the southern end. You really do have to take the left goalpost.
Well, in fact, I saw Clayton Lamb lining up before the game, and he was aiming to that far left point post, Kim, and he was kicking goals.
Delaney looks for Buckley. Bow in. Christie towards the line. The ball is out of play. Turf looks in magnificent condition. Pretty warm for the players, 23, 24 degrees. Could find them out towards the end. We haven't had that sort of temperature for a while. Phillips lets Hutton go for it. Mansell in the action again. Geez, had a good first quarter. Hallahan, standing start, drives up towards the half-four line. Fiachi can't find it. Chigwin went in and out. In goes Fidge for the Shepherd. Fiachi around the corner, but Delaney's there, read it beautifully, and he'll bolt down the outer side. There's Smith against Rubinick on the far side, one-on-one. Buckley wants it in if they can get it. If Smith can win the football, Buckley's 20 metres on his own. He won't, however, he's still working hard for the football. Delaney might give it to him. He'll come in board, intercepted Hallahan.
Two mistakes to Delaney, and you won't see that very often. Plenty of pressure, and there's almost a brawl in the square between Foster and Fidge.
Yes, a little bit of byplay there, but the grab's been taken by Captain Courageous Scooter Salisbury in his last league game of football. Let's have a look how it happened.
Good work by Salisbury on that occasion as the ball came in, but there was a lot of tension in the square. Foster went back to pick up Fidge as Delaney was down the ground.
The Tigers need a captain's goal. Has he let them down? I don't think he has. He's banged it through.
2-1 to nothing. The Bays start well. Ball lays through, can't get it. Socket off the ground to the outer side. Once again, one-on-one. Smith and Rubinick. Smith in front, needs support. Foster's out there. With him is McKay, and the ball goes out of play at centre wing on the outer side. Throw in. Solid breeze. The Bays would want three or four at quarter time. They desperately want to beat Port Adelaide in a final. Not often they do that, if ever. Long kick by Mansell, in towards down the forward pocket. Fidge comes to meet it. Fidge has got it, slips it back to Salisbury, but the handball was not good, and he thumped it straight out of play for a throw-in.
And there's not many changes on the ground. It's pretty much as we expected. Kim Hodgman in view at the moment. The Hodges-Rouvray, as we expected, Smith, Seabohm and Buckley Marshall. So coach is going in pretty much as planned.
Northeast gets the kick away. The back play is very good by the Tigers at the moment. And this man, recruited from Mount Burr many years ago, down the southeast. It's the kick up towards centre-half forward. Lamb from behind, kicked four last week, play on the call. He kicked three of those four in the final term against the Eagles when the game was well and truly won. And we'll have a bounce down about 48 metres out from goal as John Cale looks on tensively.
And Clayton Lamb is a real horn to Port Adelaide. He has 50 goals for the season, a real opportunist half forward. There's not much he can't do, and he hasn't won a flag yet. Be looking for it today.
Michael Abbott puts ball to ground. Chalmers wins another tap. It's punched on out there by Northeast. Brown is there, so too Thompson. Paddling it forward, well done is Lyndon Bowe. He chips out a short pass, and he finds Nicholas Chigwin. So the Tigers doing all the attacking at the 8.5-minute mark of the first term here at Footy Park. He hangs it up in the breeze. Fidge underneath it. That was easy for Delaney. So one-on-one, Delaney has won all three contests. He's let himself down with a little bit of poor kicking. This time he feeds it off to Rosonico, former Collingwood player, puts it out to Abernathy, also had a stint with the Pies across the border. He in turn gives Buckley the run of it. Now Buckley, a very composed player, but that's a wobbly old kicker, went straight to the Tigers. Doofy goes off the ground. His kick's taken by Fiacci, who's well down the ground. He puts it forward. Doofy couldn't control it. Chance for the Magpies. Williams played for free kick and he got one. Whoa, he ducked his head. We'll have a look at that one.
The Glenelg player's really dirty on it. Here we go. Down he goes. Well, he was actually over the top of the ball, so in retrospect, a fair free kick. He was, as the Williams boys always are, in for the ball first.
Yes, fair point. He was right over the football. He kicks from about 45 metres out into the breeze. And Stephen Williams has missed. So 9.5 minutes in, Port Adelaide get their first score on the board. They now trail by 12 points.
10 minutes, tough breeze. Would have been a good one, but as you can see, that breeze is carrying the ball at least 10 metres across the face of goal.
Rouvray puts it out in front of Mansell. That's a good kick. Buckley won't catch him. Gives a run now to Thompson, going through centre wing. Off goes Fidge, but he's behind Delaney. One-on-one, Fidge! He couldn't quite get that one. The umpire's going against Fidge and giving the free kick to Delaney. The crowd are not impressed. Neither, might I say, is John Fidge. Chalmers, well played against Jamison. Kicks long to the half-forward line. Williams, McKay up over the top. Mark Williams through, did it well. The veteran's going to get collared. Down he goes. Well, he changed his mind. The umpire's playing to advantage. The Bays into attack. Mansell having his umpteenth kick. Fidge on the lead. And this time he finds it. Well, he's tucked himself into a pocket.
Yes, he had to go to the leg, and by that I mean Mansell's a right footer. He was under pressure, so he had to run straight into his vision. He did it beautifully to put himself in position. It is a tough corner. Now, we'll be right behind him, and if Fidge knows what he's doing from here, he'll aim straight for that left-hand point post and watch it come back.
Might even have to go outside. That Neville will soon know. Delaney on the mark. He goes out. That ball comes back. It swings back. He's picked it beautifully.
Back in the centre, and Chig Whitten over the football. Glenelg have 3-1, Port Adelaide 1 point. The ball goes out to Phillips. He hasn't had a touch yet. Jamison first there, can't control it. Went back into the traffic. He's dispossessed. The handball goes out from Lamb, out towards Bowe. He passes it out towards Fidge again. And Delaney picks up another free kick.
Well, he asked what it's for, but the umpire really watching those two. And that's the second free kick that Fidge has given away for hanging on to Delaney.
Five kicks to Delaney, and this time Phillips picks up his first kick, and the youngster, tongue-in-cheek, goes for a run, has a bounce, drops in a short pass. Williams couldn't get there. It's picked up by Abernathy. Beautiful kick. Hodges gets his first opportunity. He tries to fist it towards the goals. Thompson is there, tackled by Jennifer. Rouvray there as well. Into the back of Smith. Play on the call. Seabone gets the handball out. It goes to Hallahan. They call him the Bear. He's on the left boot. He kicks one out wide. That's his fifth kick, and he finds Mars. Or the veteran, it could be his last game as he drives it in long. What can Fidge do? He can fall over. That's not what he wanted to do. He loses possession. Delaney takes it. The Port supporters like that. Chipping in his Lamb, going through his Buckley. Play on's the call. Port have the numbers and the footballers. Brown streams forward, drives out a pass, and he's found Stephen Williams.
Way to numbers and more desperation on that occasion, as you call it, Kim. And that's really what Port Adelaide are about in finals. You have to match that to beat them.
The Magpies need to convert. That's not a bad-looking kick. Getting back underneath it and taking a good mark is Christie, and that's tremendous back play by the ruckman. And tragically for Fidge, he fell down when he had plenty of space.
That's exactly what you want your ruckman to be doing, getting back, making it hard for the opposition forwards. Reminiscent of number five for the Glenelg side, Peter Carey. He did that so well in his career, Ian.
Certainly, D. Reeves was a master. One thing about Port Adelaide, they're making some distance into the breeze, so it's not all that strong out there. Hallahan does it well. Chig Whitten off the half back line. The Bays into attack again. Up towards Mansell. In there was Murphy. Took one high, but the ball trickles off the fingers and out of play. Throw in on the half forward flank, almost up to centre wing. The Bays by 18 points, 14 minutes into the 92 grand final. Charles and Murphy. Lamb waiting behind, but the ball comes down towards Hutton. Not a good kick. Marshall gets a good one. Lamb higher than longer. Rubinek's going to have to stand his ground now with Rowan Smith. Over the top comes Phillips. Hard work in there. Finally, it comes out to northeast. floats one towards centre wing. Brown's looking for it, can't get the set. Two on one, Bow against Brown and Hutton. Quickly and Hallahan slips it out. Brilliantly done to Bow on the lead. Now is Fidge. Fidge makes a meter and he's done it again. Well, that beautifully done. Gee, knows where to lead.
Well, Hallahan, he had to make up his mind 35 metres from the play. He sprinted to get there to give Brown assistance and managed to get the ball brilliantly to Bow. The kick in was good and Fidge again. So right behind him again, and you'll notice he, once again he will head for that left-hand point post. He did almost virtually the same position 5 minutes ago.
Kicks this and it's a miracle. Puts it out wide. Oh, have a look at that breeze as it twisted it right away. In the end, it was lucky just to make a point, but that's what it did make, and the Bays go on to 3-2. Port Adelaide is a point.
So nothing in it at the moment, and we're now making good use of the breeze. They've kicked three goals. We're 14 minutes in, and we're estimating it to be worth five or six, although we noticed in the reserves game, the Eagles did kick goals into it, so that's possible too.
We're at the 15-minute mark of the first term as Delaney goes short and gee, nearly found Brown. They have the numbers. Northeast did well to give it back to Brown, so they will get out of trouble. The Magpies need to score into this breeze. They put it out towards Darren Smith and he takes it nice and he went to play on. He was accidentally tripped and Michael Abbott gave him the benefit of the doubt. The short pass into Buckley. Salisbury is there. The veteran opposed to the youngster taking the mark. Enormous future this lad has in front of him as he puts it up looking for Hodges. Rouvray back there, and he couldn't take the mark. Play on's the call.
As he put the ball to ground, had two grabs at it, but couldn't manage it, and maybe a little bit lucky there. He scooped the ball back under him, and under the holding the ball rule, could have got King, but Michael Abbott had better vision than any of us.
A bounce about 15 metres out. Christy Apo. Oh, Smith got manhandled, and that was seen by umpire Michael Abbott. Well, we saw it from up here. Christy saying he was held first, but gee, nevertheless, you just can't grab somebody and throw them out of the way.
No, that's a dead set a free kick, and you're right, Kim. The umpire obviously didn't see the first infringement. If, in fact, it was there, I didn't see it either. And Smith from 15 metres. Port would love this one.
It's very important kick for Darren Smith and his side. Supporters ride it with him. He should kick it. Goes away to the right a little bit. Has he squeezed it through? He has, only just, but the Magpies are on the board as far as goals are concerned, and it's taken them 16 and a half minutes to get their first.
But it's a steadier. Have a look at this. On left of screen, pulled out of it, and a free kick's that close to goal, particularly when you're your side playing so well. To give a goal away that easily always irritates coaches, but nonetheless, Christy says he was held. Umpire didn't see it, so Port Adelaide a nerve settler.
The Bays by 13 points, 3-2 to 1-1, 17 minutes in. Chalmers thumps it towards Smith on the half forward line. William Stephen type can't. Chig Whitten gets it out to Seabone. In turn, it's Jamison that sends him into attack up towards the half forward line. Fiacci's there, off the fingers, Phillips. Now Fiacci again, coming across now to Jennifer. Jennifer goes long to the half-forward line, getting back on its biscuit up over the top. Great mark, Duthie. He judged it better than the rest. Duthie will go in short to Salisbury. Mansell's there as well, just as well, because the pass was offline. On the outer side, Lamb skipped the troop. Oh, the umpire said he's going to pay the mark and all the free. Whatever, Lamb has got the football. Now, where's Fidge? Fidge is in the square. He hasn't led. Delaney and Chalmers are back there with him. Fidge is going for home.
I'd back him from here, Daisy, with this breeze.
Wind assisted if he gets onto it. Nice looking kick. It's going to be touch and go. He's made the distance, but he's just offline. 1 point only to the Bays and Clayton Lamb.
And well capable of making the distance outside 50 with the breeze. And that's the only time to really take advantage of the breeze. Other than that, as we said earlier, the same game plan should apply. Use the ball properly with the breeze and make maximum with it when you're in distance of goal.
We're at the 18 and a half minute mark, and Port Adelaide only trail by 14 points. If they can maintain that deficit, I think they'll be pretty pleased after the first term. It is a strong breeze. Glenelg doing the majority of the attacking, but Port Adelaide just starting to get some rhythm into their game over the last few minutes. Seabone kicks it out wide, not all that direct. Hallahan at the front for the crumbs. Fidge back there takes the crumbs. Oh, here's the snapshot. What's it like? It's in the right direction. It's wide, and in fact, it is out of bounds on the full, and there's loose players everywhere for Port Adelaide.
Yes, Port Adelaide want to get on with it quickly and try and move up again into this breeze.
Chalmers kicks long underneath it. Buckley couldn't take it. Back there is Christie. Buckley recovers beautifully. Race for pace. Hutton and Marshall there. Marshall has the football. It's held to him. He flicks it out. And, oh, terrible decision by Michael Abbott. Did not give the players time to get rid of the ball or to work its way free. He was on the blind side, though. I think perhaps he thought it was trapped underneath Marshall. 19 and a half minutes into the first term. 1-1 plays 3-3. Christie again. The ball goes down towards Jennifer. It's close to the boundary line and, in fact, is over the line.
The Bays, a 14-point advantage. We reckon it's a 4-5 goal breeze. Halfway, almost two-thirds away through the quarter. Maybe Port Adelaide have done it okay. Buckley hooks around the corner. This will be a difficult one to read. Oh, McKay did it well. Goes through centre, kicks in long. Murphy underneath the ball. Delaney. Oh, beautifully thrown out. Rizonico put Chalmers under all sorts of pressure. Lost the football. Rowan Smith against Salisbury. Rubinick's there. Fidge on the lead. Chips him out, and that's beautifully put. Oh, Fish lost the handle, and he's fumbled it out of play.
Well, the Port Adelaide fans are absolutely delighted about that, but Salisbury's bit of play to elude his direct opponent in the Port defence gave Fidge a beautiful opportunity, but went astray.
Clayton Lamb hooks around the corner again. Fidge out in front. Delaney's there as well, supported by Rizonico. He's got time to have a look. Oh, the Port Adelaide machine starts to run. Williams off the half-back line. Goes in looking for Buckley. Check side of the centre line. Off goes Darren Smith. Borlase goes the other way out wide. Getting back under it and taking a fine mark is Visca.
Visca chips out a short pass looking for Rubinick. He has the job of standing Rowan Smith this afternoon. The handball goes out to Thompson. Has one to beat in Brown. Did it quite well. Puts it up towards centre-half forward. Chalmers at the back of the pack. Couldn't take it. Lamb looking for the crumbs. Went to ground. Lost his footing. Loose ball. Fiachi couldn't control it. Mansell went through like a truck. Tiger supporters want a free kick. The handball goes out to Rizonico. In turn to Greg Phillips. I tell you what, this defence of Port Adelaide is marvellous, and that's why they've been such a fantastic side for so many years, as Foster puts it up high. Out there, the Tigers have the numbers. That was a throw by Seabone and seen by umpire Kevin Chambers, and the recipient of the free kick will be Darren Smith.
Smith to send Port Adelaide into attack. 22 minutes gone. Goes towards the half forward line. Out comes Hodges, with him Rouvray. Rouvray's got the football, can't get clear. Slips it back. That's well played. He gave it away to Christie. In turn, Visca puts it out. Chigwidden needs a set. Murphy's going to give him the football. He's got to go back and get it. Could go back to Murphy in the double play. He needs a set. He's got it. Oh, does it beautifully around Jennifer. Fidge on the lead, and that's where it ends again.
Well, it's Murphy's first touch, and he did it very, very well. Kept composed, waited till he got Fidge in his sight, and just put in a beautiful little chip, left footer, and Fidge will kick from about 55 metres. We saw Lamb made the distance easily about 2 or 3 minutes ago.
Fourth kick, still has to take the left goalpost. He's already got 1-1 and one out on the foot. John Fidge. Oh, screw. Well, I don't know why he opted for the screw punt. I don't think I've seen him kick one of those this year. And he's gone off the side of his boot and out of play on the foot.
Well, wrong choice. And we saw him put a mark down before. And that kick won't do his confidence any good. He could have easily have made the distance. He's a massive kick with a drop punt. And as I said, that won't do his confidence any good at all.
Mark Williams brings the ball back into play. Oh, classic grab by Nathan Buckley. That was a gem up high. Beautiful hands. That's what football's all about. He came from three deep and completed the mark. He's taking plenty of time. Kick number six at the 23-minute mark. It's pretty good distance. Duthie front position, going through his C-bone. Dispossessed by Smith. The kick wasn't effective. He's still in there, Darren Smith. It's flicked out. C-bone there. Abernathy likewise. Hallahan goes in solidly. The ball is held to that player, and we will have a bounce. Great game of football, and Port Adelaide doing very well into the breeze.
Yes, they are, and the pressure around the packs at the moment to get a loose ball. They're matching the numbers, both sides matching numbers, and matching commitment and courage at this early stage.
A chance now for Bowe, has to go for the safety of the line. Port Adelaide doing what they want, in as much as they're eking out the seconds. They've only got a 14-point deficit, and at this stage, almost 24 minutes in, is not all that bad. Christie against Chalmers. Mansell can't find it. Mark Williams gives it a well across to Abernathy. Port into attack again to the half forward line. Stephen Williams getting back fine, Mark John Seabone. And I'm sure that Kim Hodgman will try to get this player to play again next year. Oh, that kick. Gee, it was tight, but it found Mansell. Check side of the centre line. Murphy comes in short. Chig Widdens there. Oh, the kick's offline. Picked up by Rubinek. Slipped out now to Jamison. Oh, held back beautifully. Gives a chance to Lamb. Off goes Fidge again. But that's going to be a difficult one to grab. Fidge and Delaney. Well done, Delaney, but only back as far as Jamison. Back out now to Rouvray up on the field. He's lost the football and Foster's away. Gives it away now to Buckley. Bounces his way down the outer side. Still no one putting any pressure. He could go all the way. He's going to be shepherded now. 45 out. Can he do it? The kid gives it a belt and he's missed, I think. What a great goal that would have been. A sensational run from the half back line, but just pulled it too far across goal.
Well, he's a champion player for his age. We know that magnificent margin in the Magarey Medal. He played some brilliant football during the year, and the finals certainly haven't hurt his nerves. He's very calm, very relaxed, and unlucky not to score then.
The ball now put out towards Andrew McKay. He had to mark that. It was two against one. If you back this lad on most occasions, he's a very solid player. Recruited from the southeast down at Lucendale, he drops it out towards Marshall. He's getting a belting at the moment from Nathan Buckley. That's his second kick. Buckley's had seven. The ball goes to Murphy. Couldn't take it. It hits the ground. Port Adelaide are magnificent in defence. Some real desperation showed there by, I think it's Salisbury. We'll have to wait and have a look. And it is Scotty Salisbury playing his last game for the Tigers.
And the Port Adelaide defence, as we talk about them, able to take possession, change the play and get run off the half-back line. And that's really where they start their attack, Port Adelaide.
Allahan was dispossessed. The ball's by the boundary line. We've hit time on in this first term. We've had nearly 26 minutes. Port Adelaide 1-2, Glenelg 3-3. Michael Murphy, Phillips from behind. The free kick's been picked out. It will go the way of the Tigers. Let's see who takes the free kick. I would imagine it would have to be Murphy.
Not featuring that much in the game so far, but what he's done pretty well. A good 3-1, a good chip to Fidge previously, and the umpire just sorting things out. He should make the distance. Let's hope he doesn't try a torpedo like John Fidge did. Drop punt on that left-hand point post, and he should kick a goal.
This is his third kick. He's had one handball. He's taken plenty of time. Normally not a bad kick. Pretty tough angle, though, because he needs distance as well. He didn't start that one to the left far enough, and it's a classic example of when players just strive for that little bit of extra distance, and that's the second one out of bounds on the full for the Tigers.
And, Kim, as I said earlier, with this breeze, if you think you can kick it, it's fine to go for it, but you've really got to treat the breeze like it's not there and do what you would normally do in a match day. And in a match day, he probably would have given that off to somebody.
Chalmers, what a fine mark on the half-back line. Chalmers to send the Magpies up over the centre line. 2 minutes of time on gone. He kicks a ground-covering kick. Smith's on the lead. With him up there is Seabone towards the line. Hutton tries to crash his way through, but it's a throw in at centre wing.
And Port Adelaide got the points this quarter, Daisy. We reckon it's at least a five-goal breeze and only about 13 separating them.
Couldn't agree more, and Buckley comes over the top and wastes just that few more seconds. Buckley in superb form, as well he might be a champion in the making, the 1992 Magarey medalist. Comes back towards Brown once again, the seconds tick away, and it's take three in the same spot, throw-in boundary line at the interchange goal.
John Cale would be very happy with their first quarter, and it'll be interesting to see just how Port Adelaide used the breeze in this second quarter.
As the ball goes down to Buckley again, traps it beautifully. Another kick for the 92 Magarey medalist. That behind there was Thompson going through as McKay. Geez, good this lad. He puts it up to centre half forward, one-on-one. Phillips uses his body and takes the grab. Very hard to move a man that big. Phillips stood his ground. He fed it off to Rizonico, puts it out wide. It's a race for pace. Rowan Smith out there. Will the ball sit? It does. Rubinek cuts him off at the pass. Smith has to put up a high handball to Foster. They're under pressure. Foster did it well. In fact, he did it extremely well to get it back to Smith, who spears out a pass. The siren goes. Honours to Port Adelaide in that first term. They trail 1-2, 8 points. Glenelg leading 3-3, 21.
Welcome back. That is the scoreboard after the first term in the 1992 Grand Final. Port Adelaide trailing 1-2 on 8 points. Glenelg leading 3-3-21.
Yes, and the goal scorers, Glenelg, Mansell, Salisbury and Fidge each with one. And Darryl Smith playing well at centre-half forward with Port's only goal.
And Rick, Port Adelaide did pretty well in that first term. Glenelg off to a good start, didn't capitalise.
Yeah, they certainly did, Glenelg. They shot off to a good start. Buckley, like, why wouldn't you have someone on him? The Magarey Medal.
As I mentioned before, I would have had Lyndon Bowe there and Marshall on the wing. Graham Campbell is down on the boundary. And, Graham, how does it feel down there?
Well, I've got to say, Kim, that's a big quarter by Port Adelaide. It may seem like the Bays have got some sort of a hold on the game, having kicked 3-3, but to my mind, Kim, it's a 10-shot breeze. They've only had 6 shots for goal, and the Port have had 3 shots into it. That's a fair quarter for Port.
And a man that got off to a good start for the Tigers was Darren Manswell.
Yep, sure. He had 2 chances, missed the first one, got the second one. Kick off the ground. They're always fortuitous, those sort of goals. But then again, in grand finals, those sort of things happen.
Yeah, so the Salisbury goal a little bit later on, that was another good one, Kim, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. He's a good player, Scotty Salisbury. He's not quick, Graham, but he gets to the football.
Well, he's what I call a mad goer, Kim. And when he marked that ball, I thought he'd miss that goal. He's not really a great goal scorer. And he had the quick 2 steps and went bang and put it through. If he had gone back and concentrated, he would have missed it.
Thank you for that, Graham, and we'll get back to you later in the game. It's now back to end day.
Umpire Michael Abbott about to get the second quarter underway. It's the Bays by 13 points. But our boys feel as though it's not quite enough with the breeze. Graham Campbell said it's a 10-shot breeze down at ground level. The start of the second quarter, Glenelg 3-3, Port Adelaide 1-2. Thumped away there by Christy Abernethy. Gets it up towards the half four line. Not a good kick. Seabohm has to go for the safety, however. Duthie through, intercepted. Well done, Borlase. Has his first kick, but it's going back towards Visca, and he takes a strong mark on the half back line. The Bays are well served across half back with Visca and also McKay, and of course they've got the experience of Seabohm. Murphy, no, that's Jamison up there now. Now Jamison has got Rubinick going wide. He does it well. Rubinick elects to play on, gives a chance. Chigwood, no, he's going to run into trouble. Back to Hallahan. Where's Fidge? In there to Rubinick. Oh, and a roundhouse right from George, almost dismembered his head.
Well, if you have to, well, that's 50. Now that's what the 50-meter rule should be used for. Now that just because he didn't hit him doesn't excuse him from it, and. I mean, that is just so obvious, and the umpire, Michael Abbott, has had enough experience for grand finals, should have been 50.
Just as well he didn't hit him, would have finished on the Grange golf course. Rubinick didn't read the breeze at all well. In fact, Fidge takes a mark on a boat, runs into goal and gets it. Oh, boots his second. What terrible checking by the Port Adelaide defence.
Well, the kick in offline, and Fidge the only one really concentrating on it. In it comes, Fidge right behind the goals. He started back to Lane, he just lost him. Lost him in the sun, and even Chalmers didn't jump for the ball. He went back there to lend a hand with height. Oh, a terrible mistake by the Port Adelaide people in defence, and we've seen a couple of them now, a couple of mishandles and a couple of missed kicks.
Quite incredible. Glenelg get one into the breeze. They lead 4-3, Port Adelaide 1-2. That was absolutely amazing. McKay is there, stands his ground as per the norm. Players jump on top. Abernathy is there, so too Mansell. So we've had nearly 2 minutes of the second term. Port Adelaide 1-2, Glenelg 4-3. Umpire Michael Abbott has the ball. He's officiating with Kevin Chambers this afternoon. We're on Nine's Wide World of Sports, the 92 Grand Final. Chalmers wins another tap, but he was into the back then of Christie. And Christie gets a free kick. Pretty warm out there this afternoon. 22 degrees, in fact. That's a lovely kick, and it goes out towards Marshall. Marshall may have been moved. We'll try and pick that up as the ball now goes in towards Hallahan. The Bear puts one up high. It's not the best kick he's ever done, but a chance for Fidge, and he's got it. Well, Fiachi was there. He would have heard the thundering feet of John Fidge approaching, and Fidge took it on the chest.
5 marks and 6 kicks, but whilst that was a good mark, what is significant at the moment is within 2 minutes of this second quarter starting, Nilga having their second shot at goal, having already kicked one, and this man in vision did just that. This could be a very important part of this grand final, particularly if Fidge converts this one.
He's kicked 2-1 so far and one out on the full. Two out on the full, I should say. He starts it in the right place. In fact, he's kicked that one too powerfully, and the breeze never really got hold of it, so he gets another point at the 3-minute mark.
And he'd be suitably annoyed. The breeze has shown us its character all day, that if you put it up high, it'll move the ball 15 or 20 metres. He did everything right there, and the breeze just hit it. Well, as I said earlier, every now and then you hit a dead spot, and the ball goes exactly where he kicked it. So his second point, two out in the full. So he's had one, two, three, four, five, six shots at goal.
Delaney, the kick's not a good one, a tumble punt. Foster couldn't, neither can Abernethy. Mansell's in there, Hallahan as well. They stack up. Finally, it's thrown out now towards Christie. Christie gets one on the half forward line. Mansell! Well, Port Adelaide under pressure, Neville.
Just volume of opportunities and distributions into their forward line for Glenelg at the moment.
Oh, Fidges, at least Fidges on the lead. Mansell's kick wasn't all that good. Going in quickly now, Clayton Lamb shoots in high. Oh, the umpire goes galloping. That's fishtailing all over the place. And in the end, he said, it's only 1 point, and that is Clayton Lamb's second.
And Scotty Salisbury's got the job on Nathan Buckley at the moment, or at least he's picking him up currently.
So Marshall has been moved to a wing, and as Neville mentioned, Buckley has now got Scott Salisbury to contend with. Somewhat of a mismatch in pace, but I can assure you Salisbury will keep his mind on the job and he'll make Buckley earn every ball, as Salisbury got to that contest again. And he did well. Michael Abbott says it's a dead heat. Buckley thought he'd taken the mark. I think Salisbury may have just stuck a mitt in him there.
And Scott Salisbury, number 36, he'll make game coming live from Footy Park on Nine's Wide World of Sports. Absolutely everything. He is obsessed and has no regard for his own physical well-being, Scotty Salisbury.
High tackle by Abernathy. Free kick to Mansell. He's becoming a real factor in this game, finding a lot of the football. Nine kicks already and two handballs. This time he goes out wide. He's looking for Marshall. Foster came over the top and he'll take that over the boundary line. And quite happy just to get a breather across the half back line there. 5 minute mark, Port Adelaide 1-2, Glenelg 4-5. The only time Glenelg have defeated Port Adelaide in a grand final was back in 1934, and they won that game by a mere 9 points. Fiarchi over the top, thrown out of it, and the tackle high, according to umpire Kevin Chambers.
Fiarchi off the half back line, centres the ball. Smith comes up there, but in front, good mark taken by Salisbury. Adding some strength to that spot, slips it out now to Hallahan, having his umpteenth kick. Kicks in long, up towards the half-forward line. Murphy! Strength, courage, did it well. In the square is Fidge. Intercepted this time, Delaney. Well, Murphy did the right thing. It was almost an impossible shot from where he was. Fidge alone in the square, but the wind is fickle, and Delaney intercepted quite easily in the end. Returns the ball towards the centre. The back of the pack, they got a chance now through Hutton. Great tackle put on him by Salisbury. Down they go. Salisbury still in there. Out to Mansell. Chips it out, but off the side of the boot. Rowan Smith has time to have a look. No one to kick to, or has he? Darren Smith. Too far for that player. Rubinick bearing down upon him. Smith well played. Bad tackle there by Rubinick. Puts it in towards the half-forward line. Stephen Williams. Over the top comes McKay and sends the ball out of play. And the two umpires working in tandem with goal umpire and boundary umpire said the ball was out before Stephen Williams tried to thump it forward.
And Port Adelaide just not getting an easy ball into their forward line at the moment. Glenelg putting so much pressure on upfield, their forwards just nothing emerging for them at all.
Tigers lead by 21 points at the 7 minute mark as the ball's taken by Jennifer. He gets the snapshot away. Hodges is there, opposed to Rouvray. They haven't had a lot of opportunities either player, but at this stage, Rouvray on top. Hodges yet to get a kick or a handball.
And we've seen Rouvray having to take on some giants over the last month. He's done it pretty well, and he's a good pacey defender. He's not afraid to run off his player, and he can match Hodges in height.
Big lead from behind by Mark Williams. He took the football, got the handball away. Rouvray went through. Opportunity now for Borlase. He's been quiet. The ball goes out to Duthie. Smith committed himself. Borlase gets another attempt. Couldn't get ball to boot cleanly, though. In there, there's a heap of desperation. Williams went through with the boot, and the crowd appreciate the efforts by both sides.
Well, that particular 30 seconds is a good phrase in describing the desperation Glenelg have shown. And as I said earlier, they'll have to match that all day with Port Adelaide because that's their trademark.
The Magpies have gone 8 minutes without a square hook. Scott Hodges had an airy. Hallahan, well done. Back to Mansell. Playing fine games, both that pair, as he bounces his way out of defence. doesn't know where to go in the end, or puts it into Rubinick. He's got problems. Back now to Salisbury. Salisbury ducks the chutney, lost the football. Mansell in against the tide. Strong work. Foster hooks it back towards the half forward line, over the top of Williams. They come, dunked it back to Thompson. Thompson's got time to have a look as he straightens up. The kick is not a good one, and Rowan Smith at centre wing can't control it. Neville, that ball must be exceedingly hard to kick into the breeze. It's wobbling all over the place.
Well, the only player I've seen kick well into the breeze has been Nathan Buckley. Real control, depth and power.
At the throw-in, Hallahan again. Only Grubbers won as far as Chig Whitten. Got it to Lamb, did it well. Now the Bays into attack, up towards the half-forward line. Jamison grabbed high. Gee, it's one-on-one. Fidge and Delaney. Lamb is elected to play on. Fidge on the lead. Can't quite get there. Doubles back again. He's got a chance here. Crashes his way through. Can't get a kick away. And it's northeast for Port Adelaide coming away.
They didn't do it all that well, the Tigers. Chigwin and Fidge. Chigwin didn't know where to run. Now it's the Magpies' opportunity to go into attack as Smith gets it out to Ginnivan. Back to Smith in the old 1-2. He in turn punches it forward. There's Hodges. He didn't take it. He's hit. It's a free kick for a push in the back, and it could be 50 if they're not careful.
Well, it was certainly a late attack on the player, and it was over the shoulder from Rouvray. Technically, the free kick is there, and the umpire, good vision, he saw it. But some would argue it's a bit soft, but nonetheless, technically it's there. And Port Adelaide, they are desperate to kick this. We're 10 minutes into the second quarter. They have one goal only.
And this is Scott Hodges' first kick in 1990. The last time these two sides met in the grand final, he kicked 6 goals, 5. And they need one at the moment. He lines them up. And he has banged it through. They needed that one.
The Magpies 4-5. Correction, 2-2. The Bays 4-5. Both Port Adelaide goals have come from frees in front of the sticks. Smith through. Marshall can't find it. Coming out is Ginnivan. Floats one in towards the half forward line. Hodges, Rouvray. At the back is Visco. Well backed up. He's got to go for the safety of the line as no play was evident. And it's out of bounds on the half forward right flank with Port Adelaide in attack. Well, it took them 10 minutes with the breeze to get their first score. They trail by 15 points. Smith's in there and he thumps it back from whence it came. Another throw in at the 50-metre mark. Wind assisted. We reckon it's 4-5. It hasn't proved that way yet. Although, as we mentioned, when Graham Campbell was down there, he said it was very brisk. Over the top will come Seabone. Thompson slips it over to Chig Whitten, couldn't find the handle. He bottles the ball up and umpire Chambers will have to bounce.
11 and a half minutes into this second term. 2-2 plays 4-5, 29 points opposed to 14. The ball hits the ground. Thompson up high. He goes towards the boundary line. He'll adopt similar tactics to what Port Adelaide did in the first term going into this breeze. The Tigers have proved it's quite capable of scoring into this breeze. Marvellous atmosphere here. Crowd of around 43,000 people. Big fist away by Seabone. It goes down to Rubinick. Should jam it on the boot. Gets the kick away. It's a low one looking for Hallahan. Trapped it sensationally. That's good work by Foster. Owen Smith nearly stole it, but the ball was out of play, so we'll have a throw in once more. 12 minutes into the second term. Chalmers front position. Christie from behind. Christie won that one. It went down to Salisbury. Tried to get the handball out. Chigwidden pushes it forward. Buckley likewise. Clever work by Murphy. I'm not sure it was intended. And eventually it goes over the line. And perhaps could have done a little bit more with that opportunity.
Well, he was checkmated. And Murphy's done exceptional hand skills there to get away. But Greg Phillips did then was kept his eye on the body, not the ball, and he managed to trap Murphy on the boundary.
Marshall can't find it. Brown gives it back there to Salisbury. I think it is on the bottom, not Salisbury. In the end, it will be Murphy, and the umpire will... No, we'll take it as Murphy. And the umpire will ball it up again. Scooter Salisbury on Nathan Buckley as the anxious Kim Hodgman looks on. He's got a 15-point advantage at the moment. Chalmers gets it up towards his half-forward line. Well played. Ginnivan gives a run now to Brown. Clear now is Setri having his first run. He's 30 out. Gives it a ride. That's a brilliant kick and a goal.
A much-needed goal to the Magpies. They trail 3-2. Glenelg 4-5 back in the centre. That should lift their spirits a little bit. Seabone doing a good job. Gets the handle out to Duthie. He farms out a wide one that finds McKay. He in turn goes over the top to Rubinick. That's quick work to get it to Hallahan. The ball sits nicely. They've got the loose player in Mansell. He's got Chalmers to beat. He took his time. The ball goes in long. Getting back there is Fidge. And he's taken it. Well, all of a sudden, John Fidge becoming a factor in this game after a rather tardy start.
Well, he was absolutely out of position. And have a look at the players converging on him, including Murphy. Virtually took it one-handed and one out with physical strength. He's very difficult to beat. And he's been a real factor in this game to date. He's had six shots at goal. He's kicked two points and two out on the full. He'll kick from only 10 metres, but he's on about... A very difficult angle anyway.
And you can hear that crowd. One gets the feeling he's not the most popular person out here, certainly as far as Port supporters are concerned. Important kick. Can they get the quick reply? He's only 15 metres out. It looked pretty good off the boot. No, he's missed it. In fact, they were the Port supporters cheering.
I guess they'd be cheering now. And so at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter if Fidge has 15 shots at goal if his conversion rate isn't high. At the moment, from seven shots, only two goals. It's around the 20% conversion, and he'd want to improve on that.
The main thing is, from the Bay's point of view, he's finding the football, or it is finding him, Delaney. Kicks long, down looking for Chalmers. Christie in front and too strong. Slings it over to Marshall. Now where's Fidge? Marshall, oh, dummies in, fires in long, one-on-one. Delaney getting back on the football, lost it, but he recovers well. Slips it over to northeast, and he tumbles one back towards centre wing. The bounce favours Setry. Buckley is running, beautifully done, Setry. Salisbury can't catch him, put into attack. Out comes Hodges, at the back is Thompson, with him is Geneva, and he takes... No, the umpire has seen a free kick. It's going the way of the Bays, and will be taken in defence by Robbie Thompson.
Now it's actually Rouvray who will take the kick, but Nathan Buckley, great tap on by Setry, but Buckley's run, it reminds me of the West Coast Eagles wingman Matera, just how much ground he covers, magnificent.
Rouvray, who's fast becoming Crows status as a full back, I would think, playing extremely well in that position, as mean as they come. The kick wasn't all that good, but Marshall was in front of the pack, and he's taken the mark on the halfback flank. Fourth kick to David Marshall, starting to get into the game now. He drives up towards Jamison. Drop mark. Due to Bays need him to go well. Puts it up for Mansell. It's not a good kick. If he gets the sit, they've got a chance. Mansell has to get rid of it in a hurry. Phillips getting back on it. Man Mountain takes the mark on the halfback flank.
Not a good kick then by Mansell on the left boot and couldn't execute the football as he would have liked. Now Phillips changes tack. He puts it out wide to Brown. They need some goals, the Magpies. We're only at the 16-minute mark, so they've got plenty of time, but good pressure being applied by the Tigers. Back there is Bowe, so too Seabone. McKay lends some support as well as Seabone puts it out wide and he finds Hallahan. So they just settle things down here a little bit. He'll try and pick out the best option. He's had 10 kicks already and 5 handballs. He puts it in towards Lamb, who couldn't take it. Abernathy can. Drives it inside 50. Visca sets himself. Hodges had the sit, couldn't take it. Good handball by Darren Smith. That was a beauty. Buckley has one to beat. That was Rouvray. He did it easy. He's a class act, and he banged it through. By gee, they wanted that one.
Well, a class act, that sums up the 20-year-old Magarey medalist in South Australia this year. What a magnificent piece of work. Wide, Darren Smith did the hard work in the pack. Buckley, now he hasn't got much confidence, has he? Like, he backed himself against a player his own age virtually and similar pace and just left him in his wake. A brilliant piece of individual work. He's been controlled pretty well in this first 17 minutes, but he got away on that occasion.
Only two kicks this quarter for Buckley, but he's put Port Adelaide back in business. They're only 4 points down. Back into the action again. Smith gets taken out. The umpire didn't see it that way. Duthie goes down and will ball the ball up on the half-forward line of Port Adelaide. Their supporters justifiably start to think they're getting into the game. Christie back to McKay or Duthie on the bottom of the pack. McKay it was, and the umpire will come and ball it up, same spot. 4-6, plays 4-2. Port has not had its nose in front to this stage, and at one stage trailed by 19 points. are coming back now. Chalmers, McKay again. Great smother off the boot, Brown. Williams can't find it. Brown fights for it. Back now towards Stephen Williams. Concedes back now to Abernathy. Drops it onto his boot. Hodges on the lead. Well, I think it was possibly fortuitous. Ever was under pressure, Neville, but you've only got to get it forward.
Yes, and Scott doing the basics now. He's had to because Rubray's done such a good job on him playing in front. And they know he knows the ball's coming in under pressure. He's not going to get it without... He's not going to get it in easy, and did it well to win front position.
Hodges, nice looking kick. Port Adelaide in front in the 92 final.
Back in the centre, Glenelg have had 10 scoring shots. Port Adelaide have had 7, but they lead by 2 points in the 92 grand final. So it's nip and tuck at the moment as Christie wins the tap. He puts it out wide. It goes to Hallahan. Gets another kick. That's his 11th. It goes in the direction of Bowe. He's paddling the ball forward. Tried to soccer it off the ground. Ginnivan has it. This looks ominous for the Tigers as Port Adelaide go forward. But the mark's been taken by Thompson. His kick was smothered by Brown. And it wasn't a good play by Thompson.
So conditions now just a little overcast and that wind picking up. So... It's not easy out there, and I make the point now that if any one of these sides messes up with this breeze in any way, that'll be the ball game.
And I reckon we may get some rain in the final term, so you'd want to lead at three-quarter time. Up high is Clayton Lamb, couldn't take it. Chig Whedon pushed it forward. It went straight to northeast. Starting to look a little more composed now, Port Adelaide. Chalmers has the football. The boy from the West Coast puts it inside 50. That's direct play. But we go from the West Coast to the Southeast as... Andrew McKay takes a very strong mark and also gets 50 metres.
Against Williams for unduly wasting time. But that's a point in using the breeze, Kim. Maybe Delaney, Chalmers, made the most of the breeze, but he might have been better to have actually picked somebody out and kicked it 10 yards shorter. They didn't keep possession, and whilst he maximised the use of the breeze at the risk of losing the footy, maybe that's not the smartest move.
McKay has the football. He's in the centre square. He puts it inside 50. Setting himself behind was Murphy, but Chalmers was there. He's a master at the back play, and he plays with experience that belies his age as the ball now goes out towards Ginnivan. He was tackled. Bit of pressure out there at the moment. Going in strongly is Williams. He hasn't had a lot of the football, nor is his brother Stephen. Delaney rode the bump beautifully. There's some experience. That's good football as the crowd start to warm to this game, and Christie takes the mark, but a free kick will go the way of Rouvray for a push.
He's out at centre-half back. Borlase about to re-enter the arena. Sentry took his place. Here's a chance. Port Adelaide, David Hutton sets it up for Smith. Seabone over the top. In goes Salisbury against the tide. Showed a lot of courage. Lost the football. Seabone at the bottom of the pack. In goes Brown. Hodges out there as well. But the umpire will come and ball it up on Port Adelaide's half-forward line.
So Salisbury, Hallahan and some of the smaller players really taking up the crumbing part of the game to Port Adelaide at the moment, making sure they hit through the ball, body over it, and making it very hard for Port Adelaide to win the ball away from Tax.
Buckley gets the knock. Doothy coming to meet it. Rouvray crashes one, runs into trouble, has to throw it away. Seabone gives it away to Mansell. Mansell has got Marshall out wide, and that's where it'll end. Marshall on the half back line. Puts a low one, but... not very well directed. Oh, great run down of northeast by Lamb. Northeast gets another chance. Gives it away now. Here's a chance for Port Adelaide to go into attack. Abernathy, Hodges against Rouvray. Hodges in front. Brings down the football. Oh, could get a free kick there. Not to be. Jamison runs into trouble. Setri. But hang on. The umpires pulled it up. Setri about to have a kick. But I think you'll find a free kick will go the way of the Bays. And it'll be taken in the back pocket by Christie.
Stephen Williams off the ground. I mentioned before he's been quiet, and Daisy Borlase back into the action. Now Visco may go over the top. Does so with a short pass, looking for McKay, who stands his ground. And good shepherd there by Rouvray as McKay plays on. Puts it out wide, looking for Jamison. Northeast is there. Jamo tried to hold front position. Northeast is a tough customer, and the ball is out of play. We're at the 23 and a half minute mark. Port Adelaide maintain their lead, 32 points to the Tigers 30. This has been a tough game of football. Phillips opposed to Murphy. Ginnivan gets it, gets the kick centre field. First player there is Hutton. He takes the mark. Been a quiet player. Port Adelaide supporters, they appear to be outnumbering the Tiger supporters here. They're very vocal. This will be only the second kick from for David Hutton. Chambers wouldn't buy into that 50 metre that the... Oh, look at that, Doothy! Oh, that is a gem of a mark.
And Doothy, who would think he's a 200-game player? Have a look at that, up and over the top.
Plays on quickly, out to Hallahan, one of the better players. There's no one standing the mark. In fact, the player's been held up. Is there 50 metres? I think there is. And Mark Williams having a big word with umpire Michael Abbott.
And Kim, that, whilst he might do that, it'll do him no good. But that's a beautiful example of just how confident and their approach to the ball at the moment. Doothy, a 31-year-old, jumping over the back of the pack, really confident, really aggressive, going at the footy.
And Doothy from centre field gets the kick away. It goes down towards Brown. Brown over the top of Rubinick is there. Can't get to him. Good speed by David Brown. Rubray with a timely push. He got rid of Hodges. He did it well. Good shepherd by Visca. Hodges stood his ground and the pass goes into Rubinick and he takes a good diving mark. We've hit time on in the second term. Five kicks, five handballs for Rubinick. And he's kicked it straight out towards Jennifer, who did well. The little fella stood his ground.
Port Adelaide into time on. About to go into attack as well. Short, 8-5, the possession for there. Mansell can't find it. Quickly onto the boot now of Abernethy. Hodges looking for it. Oh, he's paid the mark, I think. Well, he didn't have a huge grab, I can assure you. Rouvray can't believe it, but I tell you, Scott Hodges will shoot for goal.
Yes, either a free kick or a mark, but he got pretty close attention there. Now, this will really test him. The Glenelg players, Christy and Visca, moving in around him. He'll only kick from about 5 metres, but he's tight to the boundary, Ian. Although he's on his right foot, he should be able to sneak it through from there.
I think he'll probably break a little. He breaks around, hooks it through, and that is a goal. Scotty Hodges boots his first, and it's second, correction. Make it three. I'll get it right in a moment. Port Adelaide move on to 6-2, Glenelg 4-6.
Yes, indeed, it is his third, Ian, and all of them have come in this quarter. He was very well controlled until midway through this quarter by Rouvray, but I must admit he hasn't had any of those kicks easy. Scott Hodges has had to work for every single goal he's got today. It's been pretty tough out there for number 11, but he's done it well, and he's got the Maggies back in the ball game.
Back in the centre once more, Port Adelaide 6-2, Glenelg trailing on 4-6. As North East took a big swipe at the football, didn't make contact, Chigwidden is in there, and North East just repeats the motion, and we'll get an opportunity to do that again. Well, this game is out.
And Kim, I really think the change in, I thought Glenelg had the ascendancy, and you just can't ever take it away from Port Adelaide. Scott Salisbury's control of Nathan Buckley in the centre did change the game, but just through other avenues, they've bounced back.
Chigwidden was in there. The handball didn't find a teammate. Now, looking to the free kick is Williams, and umpire Michael Abbott wouldn't buy into that. And away he goes again, Mark Williams. He's not shy to have a word. He's only had three possessions. And it may be in his best interest to concentrate on the football and drag himself into the game, which is possibly going to be his last game of league football. As Setri trapped it beautifully. The handball goes out toward Buckley. He could kick it from here, but he didn't bring it back to the left, and he's put that one out on the full. The distance wasn't a problem. It does appear that there could be some rain in the Adelaide foothills, heading north and over in the north, and it's heading this way. So you've got a lead. You'll be in a good position as far as this game is concerned if it gets wet and slippery. As Rouvray, Marshall up high, couldn't take it. Rubinick back of the pack, gave it to Marshall. He was under enormous pressure. Now a loose ball out to Thompson. He gets the kick away and it goes straight to Rowan Smith. Smith was keen to play on. Rowan Smith had a stint with St Kilda. Had three kicks and four handballs. Borlase provides a lead. Smith decides to kick long. Hodges will come three deep. And standing his ground and taking a very good mark is Gary Christie.
Looking pretty murky at Football Park. 28 minutes gone. Port Adelaide by 8 points. Oh. Slipping over there on the outer side. Buckley with a chance. In goes Bo. Borlase gives chase, but this ball is out of play on the full forward left pocket. If it's thundering back at North Adelaide, and if anything, I reckon the wind has gusted up a little bit since halfway through that quarter. Port Adelaide by 8 points. Must be getting dark. They put the lights on the grandstand. Mansell looks around the corner. High, floating in there, Salisbury. Just that little gentle push. The umpire didn't worry about that one. And Scooter Salisbury gets a free kick from half-back flank. Salisbury chips out the short pass in towards, oh, that's not going to be Reach's target. Northeast gives it away to Buckley. Buckley gives it a huge ride. That is not a bad looking kick, but it's offline. And despite the antics of Hodges and Rouvray in the square, it goes over their head for another point to Port Adelaide.
Siren should sound any moment now. We've had 29 minutes of this second term, and Port Adelaide looking pretty good at the moment with a 9-point advantage. So they've managed a pretty useful turnaround as the rain starts to fall here at Football Park, as we predicted. Now, Williams more or less threw that one. It went out to Smith. He, in turn, went back to Seabome. Seabome to Robbie Thompson. Thompson puts it up high. Rubinick will have to buy into the action, but Smith just too tall, too strong. Should move it in quickly. They're running out of time. He puts it towards the centre of the ground, trying to pick it up on the half volley was Brown. He did well, had good vision to see Fiachi, who slipped down the ground. So they got a long way to go, but they've got the breeze and they get it inside 50, courtesy of that kick from Fiachi. And by gee, we've been treated with some fantastic marks this afternoon, and that was a classic there by Visca.
Yes, one out contest, and Visca, eyes on the ball, managed to take it with just one hand. Beautiful piece of skills.
Short pass over the head there of Seabone. This could be very costly. Williams has it. Smith is wide. Williams goes infield back to Ginevert. Now it goes to Foster. Kicks from 49 metres out. The siren will sound any second. They've kicked it, and it's come from a Tiger error, and you cannot afford to do that in a grand final.
Well, the Tigers have gone from about a 10-point lead. It's just before time on, and now they trail by 15 points. And that might be a very ominous sign for Glenelg, should I say. Foster coming down from half back, had no trouble from the 50-metre line. And these last three or four goals from Port Adelaide, very, very important in the result of this game.
The umbrellas go up at Football Park as the rain starts to tumble down. 7-3 to 4-6. Port Adelaide make their mark on the 92 grand final as Christie thumps it out to the outer side. The bounce favours Mansell. But in the interim, a free kick will go to David Hutton, centre square. He'll play Port Adelaide into attack. Quickly now to Chalmers, who'll get run down, gets the kick away. It's a huge kick that could bounce through. Oh, what a goal! He's booted it from 80 metres, and Port Adelaide have got eight on the board.
Well, what a super piece of work. They've absolutely made the most of this breeze. They kicked only one into it. They've managed seven against it, and Glenelg have only managed two into it. So we're really and truly on top. Chalmers absolutely out of range on that occasion, but he just put it up in the air. Scotty Hodges was on a lead. The ball went over his head, and Lux of Fortune, they got the bounce and their eighth goal.
And we have hail pelting down here at Football Park. What a turnaround. It was 22.5 degrees only about half an hour ago, and the people here can't believe it. So some very valuable goals. They've kicked three in time on the Tigers, and they have an advantage now of 21 points. And as I said, that is courtesy of three goals in time on.
Well, Glenelg went into this second quarter after a reasonable first quarter. I still gave the points to Port Adelaide in that first quarter. Although Glenelg led by 13 points, I didn't think they'd use the breeze that well. Though they started brilliantly in that second quarter. And Fidge got away, didn't convert as many as he should have. Salisbury got on top of Nathan Buckley in the centre, and they really looked like they might do some damage in this second quarter into the breeze. But Port Adelaide, the way we know they can, they set up the loose man, they kept doing the hard work, they kept getting people around the ball, and Scotty Hodges, not getting anything easy, got in front, won three hard balls, kicked three goals, and Port Adelaide just haven't looked back since.
At half time in the 92 grand final, Port Adelaide 8-3, lead the Bays 4-6. We'll be back to Football Park shortly.
It is half time here at Football Park, so it's time to sit back, relax, and enjoy the entertainment provided by the Calisthenics Association of South Australia. We'll be right back.
we've been watching the Calisthenics Association of South Australia, and the girls did a marvellous job. We'll be back in a moment. Welcome back to Football Park. Let's check the scoreboard after the first half. You could see that Port Adelaide were trailing by 13 points at quarter time. Then we saw a 34-point turnaround in that second quarter, and the Magpies lead 8-3-51 to Glenelg 4-6-30.
Yes, and the goal scorers, Hodges 3, Smith, Setry, Buckley, Foster, Chalmers. They came as they will in that second quarter. Fidge 2, Salisbury and Mansell for Glenelg.
Well, Graeme Campbell is down on the boundary line once again, and the Tigers got off to a good start, Graeme, in the opening minutes of that second term, but, boy, gee, didn't Port Adelaide hit back?
Well, didn't they, Kim? Glenelg really were a credit to themselves, the way they attacked into the breeze. But, boy, if you've seen an example of persistence causing a side to find something, it was Port Adelaide that quarter. They just kept persisting. There was no great flair, no great run-on. It was just a matter of players having a dip. And finally, they break clear and got those late goals. Great. The last goal that Chalmers got really defied logic.
A great goal there, Graeme, by Fidge.
Yes, early. Like John Fidge really could have kicked 4 or 5 in that first half, all told. But sadly for him and for Glenelg, a little off target on occasions and didn't make the most of his chances.
He didn't, as we go to the other end of the ground, and Scotty Hodges kicked 3 in that second term, Graeme, after a slow start.
The only disquieting feature is Port got their first 2 goals from 3 kicks, and neither I thought were on. The free kick to Hodges really, to me, well, the mark, was paid a mark, actually, and the first free kick to Darren Smith in the first term was a bit questionable. So their first 2 goals came really from what I think were breaks.
And Graeme Setry came onto the ground and he really showed a bit of spark.
Amazing. Well, I suppose you could say Jack Carr's a genius. He brings Setry on in place of Borlase and he bobs up with a goal with a hand pass over the top. Good effort by Setry.
As you can tell by the roar, Port Adelaide have just re-entered the arena. Nathan Buckley destroyed David Marshall in the first term. Salisbury had the job in the second quarter.
Well, he did. I thought Manswell had a jag at him in the first term also, Kim. A bit of ducks and drakes there in the centre position. But Scott Salisbury was the wrong option, quite frankly, because Buckley broke away and got that brilliant goal. I knew he'd sell the dummy to Rouvray as he came down the field. And, of course, he sashayed around Rouvray and just popped it through. He's a genius, Buckley. To my mind, best on ground so far.
And Graeme, of course, Scotty Hodges, who's a real renowned goal scorer. He got a couple of easy ones early, but this was a great goal.
Yes, it was. Well, Scotty had to do something, shall we say, with a bit of flair. That's what happened. Took the mark, kicked the long goal. Not quite from Death Valley, but it was a good goal.
And Brett Chalmers, the big man. Christie's been doing a good job, but the last 15 minutes of that second term, Chalmers really bounced back.
Yeah, well, Christie is arguably Glenelg's best player, but Chalmers' goal, as I said before, defied logic. How can a big fella pick up a bouncing ball, run 5 yards and go bang from 60 metres out and clear the deck, and it went through. It buried Glenelg, sadly. I don't think their chances are all that bright just right now.
So, obviously, Graeme, your views that Glenelg in enormous trouble at the moment.
Yep.
And, Rick, can they get back or not?
Well, I've never seen such a change of the weather. It was magnificent conditions.
Not even in all your farming days?
In all my farming days, I've never seen it be absolutely magnificent and then just pouring with rain. I can't see them. Well, put it this way. I think they're under pressure.
They're under enormous pressure at the moment. As I mentioned earlier, they trail by 34 points. Oh, in fact, not 34 points. I must correct that, and I will correct it. They trail by 21 points. It was a 34-point turnaround. And as we see the players down there, John Fidge, he's had a number of opportunities. And I just wonder what Scotty Salisbury's saying at the moment. It'd be pretty obvious. On the other hand, Greg Phillips looks pretty much under control.
Yes, he certainly does. And I think Port Adelaide, you can never, ever bet against them. Danny Hughes hasn't had a run yet. I could see that him probably retiring at the end of the year. So, Port Adelaide, let's see if the Bays have got a little bit of character here, Kim.
Yes, well, I would say it's death or glory at this stage of proceedings. They must get off to a good start. They must use the breeze now, even though the ball is wet. Well, we'll know in a moment as we now go back to our commentary position with Ian Day.
Thanks, Kim. Yes, Port Adelaide has kicked the last 7 goals. Fidge kicked his second and the Bays' only goal of that second quarter in the first minute of the quarter. They went to a 19-point lead then, and Port Adelaide fiddled around for a while, but at the 10-minute mark, Hodges came into the game, and I think Neville, probably the wind gusted up a bit during the latter part of that quarter, and that made it hard for the Bays to attack into the breeze.
Yes, it certainly wouldn't have helped, but they did do it well early in that quarter, as you mentioned, and they just were unable to maintain it, but the job really in front of them now, and It might surprise people, but Glenelg have had 23 more touches overall, so they're not short of getting the football, Daisy. They just haven't been able to turn that into conversions and goals.
Yes, I think Port Adelaide has been more direct. They always play that direct game, and today it's played dividends, none more so than Chalmers' huge goal from in the centre square that brought the Port Adelaide fans to light. Everything in readiness for the start of the second half. The Magpies by 21. The Bays with a lot of work to do. Umpire Chambers in his first grand final, just waiting for players to settle. Gets the OK from Greg Phillips, and the second half about to get underway.
It appears that Kretchmer's got the job on Delaney this quarter too, Ian.
Port Adelaide 8-3, the Bays 4-6. The last half of the 1992 grand final underway. At the bounce, it is Chalmers, line ball that one. Ginnivan sends Port into attack up towards the half forward line. Brown shovels it out. Hartnorgie, that ground is slippery. Couldn't get a decent kick away. Down goes Setri as well. Out comes Kretchmer. He's on the turf, as Neville told you, and gets it out wide to Mansell. Mansell to send the Bays into attack. Short or Marshall will give it back to him in the double play. Supported now by Chigwidden. The Bays need a good start. Slips it up. Fidge about to get the leap, and Fidge has got the football. Well, he's uncanny how he finds it. Seldom does he get off the ground, but it seems to lob on his chest.
And let's have a look at how he got there. He was in a good position, stood his ground, and he seems to have tweaked a hamstring as he got up. He grabbed the back of his leg, and I'll watch that with interest. This is a routine goal for Fidge. The rain has caused the wind to die, and this is only 10 metres straight in front.
If ever the Bays needed a goal, they need it right now. 7 marks, 9 kicks. John Fidge towards the golf course end. He's popped it through. Goal number 3, and the Bays off to a good start.
Well, he appears to be moving okay, and that's very important for the Glenelg, because I think everybody in this stadium realises that if Glenelg have got any chance of winning this game, Fidge has got to be still a big part of the game. Glenelg, as they did in the first quarter and early in part of the second, running it in with numbers, getting people around the ball, and just on this occasion not picking out Fidge, but bombing it in. Good position, and he's managed to kick the last 3 goals for the Tigers, and that's what indicated to me the way he got up he might be a bit sore.
Well, the opening 4 and 5 minutes of each term haven't been a problem for the Tigers. It's the rest of the quarter that's given them headaches. As Smith gets the ball, that was slick, out to Abernathy. The veteran shows a yard two, kicks from 50 metres out. Back there is Hodges, and he's taken the grab. Well, he will be on a most acute angle, very similar to a goal he kicked in the second term. He plays on, there's the short pass, and he's found Borlase, and it's not allowed. Well, timeout had been called.
Yes, that's very frustrating, and often those opportunities come up during that time, but the umpire's still getting a line on the ball. Now time on, he can do what he likes. He'll run around, no doubt.
He did it in the second term. Has he done it again? It's not a problem for a full forward of his stature.
No, it really is quite...
The Magpies regain their 21-point half-time advantage. The Bays into attack again. Smith, Rubinek. Gee, that ground is slippery. Quickly back now to Jamison. Hooks around the corner. Salisbury it was. And it's Rozonico who takes the mark in defence. Oh, he sets up Big Chalmers. Mansell did it well. Rozonico again. Williams off the half back line will go out wide and find Rowan Smith. Getting pretty dark here at Football Park as Port Adelaide chip out the pass. And on the half back line, it's Abba. I think you'll find the breeze has dropped. In fact, the flags might be wet, but gee, they're hardly moving against the masts, and this might produce a better half from that point of view. Christie going through Mansell. Mansell kicks it out long towards centre wing. The bounce, or in comes Phillips. Getting there first was Bo. Out he goes with Jamison. Quickly back Hutton. Great tackle there by Murphy, and takes the ball out of play.
Some heavy body work, though, you expected in finals, and Murphy... Have a look at this. Great tackle. And caught the player as he was trying to kick it and then came back and stopped it from being played on. Good work, Murphy.
Chalmers front position. The ball's punched down by Williams. Punching it forward, Visca. Couldn't get much meterage there as the ball goes over the line. And for a point of interest, I can tell you at 3 p.m. this afternoon that the little country town of Ardrossan experienced 150 points of rain. You're not aware of where Ardrossan is. It's on the St. Vincent's Gulf. And my parents and my family are over there holidaying at the moment, so a good day to be watching the football because it's too wet to be outside. As Hallahan picks the ball up, gets a wobbly one. They need a bit more distance than that. Jamison had nowhere to go, and the ball goes out of play. So we've had 5 minutes of this third term. Port Adelaide lead 9-3, Glenelg 5-6.
And the challenge fairly at the feet of the Tigers as the lights come on in overcast football park. As I said, the challenge firmly at the feet of the Tigers at the moment. They mustn't let Port Adelaide enlarge this gap. They must kick goals, put the pressure back on Port Adelaide, because at the moment, Port Adelaide could start to play a little bit arrogantly.
These two sides have clashed twice during season 1992. In round 8 at the Bay, Port Adelaide won by 26 points. In round 17 at Football Park, Port won by 17 points. As the ball goes out to McKay, has a little bit of space, puts a handball over the top. It's cleverly tapped out towards Kretschmer. He's waiting for the ball to sit. It won't happen in this type of weather. Now Abernathy in there provides the pressure. That's good play. Doothy there, though. Glenelg have the numbers. They'd want to be quick, though. He couldn't get a handball away. And away go the Pies. 10 out of 10 for perseverance as Rowan Smith gives it to Buckley. Buckley goes long and he's looking for Hodges, but taking the mark is Smith. And that's a very clever grab.
Oh, I think he surprised himself. There he is, one hand out. He would have been happy, he'd be happy at training to take one of those, let alone in a grand final, 15 metres from goal. And Darren Smith, an experienced player, he won't miss this one.
Very good player, kicked one goal in the first term. He will be kicking, as Neville mentioned, from 15 metres out. He has an opportunity to extend his side's lead with his eighth kick. A deliberate shot, takes plenty of time, and he's kicked two for the day.
Port Adelaide eke out a 27-point advantage, the biggest for the game, 10-3 to 5-6. The moment of truth right now for the Bays. They need the next goal. Chalmers thumps it. Quickly in there as Jamison had an airy. Kretschmer can't get rid of it. Play on is the call. Working hard, Setri, he couldn't find it. Mansell again, for the umpires picked up a free kick and is going to Nathan Buckley. Port Adelaide in control by 21 points at half-time. 14 kicks to Buckley, drives in long. Hodges underneath the football. Play on is the call. Quickly now, into the open goal goes Borlase. Oh, gee, that's a problem. Borlase kicks his first, and Port Adelaide scoot away.
Well, Borlase, he's not short of experience either. The ball came in beautifully from Buckley. He's in his 118th game, and he's no foreigner to kicking goals. He has 118 goals with this one. He's an opportunist forward pocket or half forward. He spent a bit of time off the ground in the first quarter, but he read the crumb beautifully there. He's been pretty well looked after today by Doothy. He managed to slip away on that occasion. And as I said, the challenge firmly at Glenelg's feet, but they're just unable to do anything about it at the moment. And the dejected Scott Salisbury and Alan Bartlett.
Alan Bartlett yet to get a run. Port Adelaide lead 11-3, Glenelg 5-6. So it really is crunch time for the Tigers, and I'm not sure if they're equal to the challenge. As the ball socket off the ground, it goes out in the direction of Phillips. Well, Murphy hasn't done a lot, nor has Phillips. He just seems to negate his opponents nowadays. As Murphy gets into the action, Foster harassing, and the ball eventually over the boundary line. And it could be a very big day for the Borlase family. Daryl Borlase's wife, Jenny, currently playing in the Australian Netball Championships in Tasmania, where South Australia are in the final against New South Wales. And that'll be just as tough as this encounter, as Chalmers puts the punch away over towards Smith. Ian Turn out to Phillips. Great presence of mind then, just to kick that mid-air. Loose ball, Robbie Thompson jams it on the left boot, puts it out wide. Difficult to mark overhead now, as Hallahan experienced. Foster gets it out to Rizonico. He's been quiet. Murphy slips over. Jamison has it. The handball was absolutely atrocious. Put Chigwin under enormous pressure. He threw it. Should have been penalised. Not seen by the umpire. Northeast goes off the ground. Now flicked out by Abernathy. Rowan Smith waited. He measured the situation. That was a cool piece of play. Now it goes back to Abba again, courtesy of Brown. And underneath it is Setri. Couldn't take it. Visca's been quiet. Applies the tackle. Smith in there. Had two to beat. Did it brilliant. Now he's going to kick from 40 metres out. Where's it go? It goes through the middle, and Darren Smith has kicked three.
What a super performance from Darren Smith. I thought he was well held in that first quarter, not so much in the second, but didn't do a lot of damage. But have a look at this. He breaks the tackle on Seabone, runs over 50, dummies the handball, used his 10 metres to perfection, and then just let fly. As I said, the breeze is
stopped to nothing here at Football Park. There's no advantage at all or disadvantage. And that was a cool piece of work from the experienced half forward.
Well, the Magpies now by 39 points as the rain continues to tumble down here at Footy Park. Christie thumps the ball to the half forward line. The Bays are non-existent in that spot at the moment. Off the ground, it's difficult to pick up that football. Foster goes out wide, well played by Rubinick. He's lost the football now. They go into attack through Kretschmer. Out wide, Chigwidden. The Bays have got a chance now. Fidge went off, then lost his footing. In short, Murphy takes a good mark with the slippery ball. Fidge, good lead, got the football. The umpire didn't pay it. Little bit disappointing for the Bay supporters as Jennifer comes out with a football. Well done there by Thompson. Now it's Hutton, comes away. Port Adelaide into attack. Smith out in front of Seabone. Off goes Hodges on his lead. Put out beautifully, Scotty Hodges. Well, Port Adelaide in full flight now. The Magpies' feathers are really flying and Hodges will shoot from 35, 40 metres out.
Well, the Tigers have lost the plot here at the moment. They're not putting any pressure on players down the field and that's just how Scotty Hodges like them.
Hodges, little or no breeze. It's just a slippery ball. Not a bad looking kick. Goal number four.
Scott Hodges has kicked five goals from five kicks. Port Adelaide lead 13-3 and Glenelg on 5-6. And they've got some credibility to look after here, even if they can't win the game. There's still plenty of time, but they want to start doing something pretty quickly as Fidge puts it out with some clever work to find Seabone. And it appears a move has been made. Seabone may be playing at centre-half forward now. Murphy has gone back to Darren Smith, so the move has been made. Kick number five for Seabone. He has played as a full forward. He's no stranger to kicking goals. But as far as this afternoon is concerned, they're a little foreign to him. A point that is not what the Tigers want at the moment. We're 13 minutes into the third term.
The balance of the Glenelg side upset because of the dominance of Darren Smith and now Kim Hodgman virtually willing to try anything as he's in all sorts of strife here at Footy Park.
He certainly is. Can't get any ascendancy across centre at all. Delaney gets it back from northeast, goes in short. Brown. Delaney batters up again. Oh, lost the handle on that occasion. In goes Marshall off the ground. Northeast against Fidge. Fidge did it well. Mansell, point blank range. Oh, great tackle then by Northeast. Just edged the ball off. Abernethy gets it out in front of Brown. That's a fine pickup with a wet leather. Slips it over to Fajachi. He's got nowhere to kick. He's going to get run down. Lost the football. Seabone hasn't got it. The umpire's going to give him a free kick. Well, it's difficult out there. No question about that. Seabone can't make the distance. He's 60 metres out, and we've got a little bit of a yike going on over in the left forward pocket. Should warm the players up, if nothing else. Seabone will come in short, looking for and finding Rubinick, but I still don't think he can make the distance from the 50-metre mark, such is the state of the ball. And the rain still tumbles down. Fidge gives a lead, but a botch. Well, that gives you an indication of just how bad it is out there. When Rubinick went to kick, he just slipped straight off the ball. Zonico got it back. In comes Visca towards the half-forward line. Marshall searching for it. Puts it up for Kretschmer. Gee, it's not a good handball. And finally, Abbott takes it off him.
Abbott kicks long. Port Adelaide in total control at the moment. This man's tried hard in McKay. But you can just tell now, the Port machine, they've lifted a gear or two. They're in total control of this game, and they're just dictating the state of play.
And just a couple of occasions back there where Glenelg players gave up the ball far too easily to a tougher Port Adelaide.
Buckley over the top. He'd be thoroughly enjoying this season. Somewhat of an understatement. The football club's chasing him from all over Australia. He's won a Magarey Medal and he's well on the way to winning a premiership flag. So just a fairly tidy year for the youngster.
You'd have to say he's best on ground to date and with a real chance of the Jack Oatey Medal today, Kim.
No question, the ball is socketed off the ground. Borlase has it. Port Adelaide players everywhere. He didn't give it. Oh, that's not good play by Darryl Borlase. Had Setri there, had Hutton. They were loose. They could have run the ball down and he ignored the options.
Well, and he also had Hodges on a lead. He was 20 metres clear of Rouvray. And I think you'd see Rouvray's heart pounding under his jumper. He was so happy he didn't give it to him.
Hodges tries to hook it back. Brown in the action quickly. He'll need support from there. Gets it from Buckley. Standing start. Shoots towards goal. Don't tell me he's done it again. Oh, what a sensational goal. Buckley boots his second, and Port Adelaide on fire.
Well, Nathan Buckley, I mean, he's only playing his 36th game for the club. He's already represented the state, and he's kicked something like 44 goals with this one. That's just an indication of the class that oozes out of this player. He is an absolute perfectionist when it comes to his own game. He's a real athlete, and have a look at that. Delighted with himself.
And had every reason to feel that way. The ball's tapped back towards Abernathy. I'll tell you what Abba's getting into the game in this third term. He's had 14 kicks and one handball as the ball goes out towards Thompson. It's close to the boundary line. And in fact, it has gone over the line. And I can very well understand how Ardrossan had 150 points of rain at 3 p.m. Well, I think we're about to match that. It is absolutely bucketing down here at Football Park at the moment. What incredible turnaround. 22.5 degrees when the game started. As Murphy gets a kick away, a little hard to see on the outer side. Abernathy was up. In there is Foster. He's tackled, still has the football. But umpire Kevin Chambers decides to ball up. I dare say he will ball up and not bounce. He just tests the ground there. We'll see what he does.
And for viewers who don't live in Adelaide and even out of this country, this particular state has had something like 11-odd inches of rain in the last 4 weeks, which is half our rainfall that we expect for the year.
The Archie gets the kick away, puts it up high. Port Adelaide just attacking incessantly at the moment. The ball now goes down towards Murphy. Mark Williams been very quiet playing, perhaps his last game for Port Adelaide, but he's in there fighting and trying. And whilst he's not getting a lot of the football, he's had a lot to say to the umpires, but I can assure you he would also be giving plenty of encouragement to his teammates.
Going to be most difficult, Neville, for Port Adelaide, Glenelg, to get back in this game. 9 goals down in this weather and you've got a humongous problem.
Well, it's not even a possibility, not when you're playing Port Adelaide. If they were playing an inexperienced side, maybe you could expect them to go off the boil a little bit, but Port Adelaide will treat this game like a vice and they will just keep tightening the handle.
Well, what happens now to Graham Corn's comment after the 1990 Grand Final when he stated that Port Adelaide would never defeat the Tigers in a Grand Final again?
I don't think he'd like to be reminded right now. Visca, oh, lost the footy. That's the problem. It's so hard, or so easy to do. Finally, McKay comes away with a football to the outer side. Foster's out there, well shepherded by Abernathy. Foster again, he lost the football. And the ball is out of play.
Well, just on that, Daisy, I'll give Graham Corns an out clause. He may have meant under his coaching.
There's no doubt that he meant that, but you've still got to give Port Adelaide absolute credit. I mean, they've kicked 6 goals in these conditions, and Glenelg have only managed 1. There's no advantage or disadvantage with this breeze, so just a superior effort in tough conditions.
Certainly is. 19 points down 1 minute into the second quarter. They now lead by 50, and they go into attack again. Fiachi getting underneath the ball is a very dishevelled-looking Visca. He lost a football. Off the deck goes Sentry. Can't make it. Quickly, Rouvray, Sentry, Duthy. Into the action comes Ball Hayes, but the umpire will ball it up. No correction. It's gone out of play on the left full forward pocket.
And this weather won't ease up, Ian, and the players are just going to have to play it out. But as I said earlier, Port Adelaide, they certainly won't give up this in these conditions.
Lyndon Bow goes for a spell. Robbie Thompson off the turf. Only back as far as Brown. He can't find his feet either. Slips it across, hunting through. Can he grab it? Lost his footing. Oh, they go into the pocket. It's super hard out there. Well done, Hutton, to give a chance to Buckley. Buckley hooks, but he doesn't hook far enough. Searching for it out there is Smith. He can't keep it in play. And another throw in Port Adelaide's full forward right pocket.
And just for a fleeting moment there, I thought Nathan Buckley may perform the impossible again. He's kicked 2-2 and 1 out on the full. We're live at Football Park on Nine's Wide World of Sports. And this game had been touted as perhaps one of the best grand finals one may ever experience. Certainly not turning out that way. This methodical, business-like Port Adelaide side just tearing Glenelg apart.
We had a bit of an audio problem. We apologise for that. It's the storm overhead, of course. It's providing a lot of problems. We're getting lightning down here at the moment. Hopefully we'll stay on air. Down goes Robbie Thompson. The umpire says play on. Nathan Buckley across the ball A's. Smith back to ball A's in a double play. Out goes Hodges, but geez, on a pair of skates. He just simply couldn't stop. One on one, Rouvray and Hodges as they go to the line. Down they go, ball still in play. Christmas sandwich. Away comes Rouvray. Not a lot to kick to as he chips out the pass short. They're looking very dishevelled indeed. Murphy gives it away to Seabone. Thought about Hallahan, who's died out of the game, but a lot of Bay players have. On the other side, up goes Abba. Gives a chance, Rowan Smith. Buckley's 40 metres out on his own. If Abba wants to give it to him, he draws the player, but goes in long, in towards full forward. Almost a mark by Williams, off the deck, McKay. Kretzmer goes down, great tackle. Murphy in the action, gives it away now to Duthie. He can't find it either. And it's finally Thompson who gives it away. Or was it Visca? Gee, they look pretty dim out there now. They go into attack, up towards the half-forward line. The Bays desperately need a goal. That's the understatement of the year. We apologise, we're having all sorts of problems up here in the commentary box. The next we'll need will be an arc. We might even have to float out of here, and a few of the spectators with us. A throw in left full forward pocket. 14-3 to 5-7. It's even hard to see the scoreboard, and gee, the supporters have stayed through this. Unbelievable support. They'd have to be Port Adelaide supporters. Rosonico kicks across goal. Fidge can't. Delaney can as he chips out the pass. Oh, misdirected to Marshall, who did a Tom and Jerry and lost the footing. Off goes Buckley. Has the arrogance to bounce the football or make that the skill. 18 kicks. Duthie comes to meet it. Has to work hard for this one. Setry in there. Now Marshall again. Through goes Buckley. Kretschmer. Now Fiacci. Biachi on the left leg, heaves it towards the half-forward line. McKay and Williams, down they go, and the umpire's going to give them a free kick.
Quite incredible. I'm trying to look at the scoreboard. I think we're at the 23-minute mark. John Cale, he's down in the bunker now. He has the shirt on. It's not cold here at Football Park. It's just damn wet. Incredible. If anyone's got Noah's phone number, give him a ring because he can start building another arc. As Northeast gets a wobbly kick away, but he gets plenty of distance. McKay couldn't control it. He'd have to be perhaps amongst Glenelg's best players. Loose ball taken by Setry. They're loving this, Port Adelaide. Hodges! He's got it. Well, that's a great catch in these circumstances. And you're right, Kim. Port Adelaide love these conditions. Have a look at that. I said earlier that Scott Hodges has earned all his goals today. Nothing over the top. No easy business. And he's had some critics in the past that he needs to get the ball out in front of him and on a lead. But he's gone back to basics today in tough conditions. He's toughed it out on the contest in front. And he's earned every kick and every goal.
He's had five kicks. He's kicked five goals. He's had now six kicks. And he's kicked six goals. And the Magpies go from strength to strength in the 1992 Grand Final. What an awesome performance.
Kept absolutely goalless for the first term by Rouvray, and a good display. The carrier there was Setry, and just as I said, playing in front, basics, nothing tricky. He knew the ball would come in rough and slippery, and he took a great mark on his chest. Very difficult conditions. Two, he's kicked three in the second quarter and three in the third for a total of six. A match-winning performance.
Certainly is. 15-3, plays 5-7. Port Adelaide by 56 points. Salisbury kicks down looking for Jamison. With him out there is Rosonico. Back in defence, northeast towards Rowan Smith. Salisbury well played. Jamison tries to get a kick away. In goes northeast. Salisbury comes out with a football, but umpire Michael Abbott will have to ball it up on the half forward line. The umpire's got a super hard job to do now. It's very difficult to find the ball. They're going to have to change their style of umpiring. Chalmers towards the line. Rubinek, Abernethy, Hallahan, Rowan Smith. Oh, and just have a look at that rain bucket down. Lamb gives it away now. Hallahan boots it in towards the half-forward line. Phillips against Fidge. Rosonico taps it out looking for Delaney. If he grabs it, he'll be okay. And he kicks Port Adelaide back towards centre wing.
I cannot believe this rain. That's a very good mark there by Robbie Thompson.
overhead. We won't see too many overhead grabs now, given these conditions. Have a look at that. 10 kicks for Thompson, 4 handballs. It is bucketing down here at Football Park as Mansell, who started off sensationally. Have a look at that. 18 kicks and 7 handballs for Mansell. As Ian Day mentioned, we will float out of Football Park. Commiserations to those who have their deck chairs out in the car park with the barbecue and the esky. That's what they were doing prior to the start of the game. Big leap at the back of the pack came from Seabone, going to ground as Rizonico. Lamb off the ground. There's a goal. Christie thought about getting excited and realised how far they trail in this game.
And that's not a bad effort from Clayton Lamb. He has 2 points to date and featured early, as we said earlier, an opportunist half forward. And that's the best way to get them in this in these conditions. But I still feel that from a scoreboard point of view, these next few minutes of this quarter and the last quarter will be very interesting from Kim Hodgman's point of view, because the conditions are the same out there for both players. It's simply a matter of determination, aggression and willpower at the moment.
15-3, play 6-7. Marshall towards the half forward line. Chigwidden, Seabone well done. Great tackle there by Phillips. Allows Rowan Smith through. Out wide again is Buckley. Buckley sells the dummy, sells it twice, gets the kick away. On the fly now is Brown. Half forward line, Port Adelaide into attack again. Setry short, but he's going in longer, looking for Hodges. Thompson back in defence, or is it Duthie? Let's have a look at him. He looks pretty Thompson, it is. They all look fairly dishevelled with the rain making a mess of their hair. And that was a good mark with that heavy ball. Floats it back towards the half forward line, off the fingers. Rizonico up at centre wing at the moment. Duthie, ball aids. Thompson, it's hard work out there, I can tell you. And finally it comes out to Brown again. He puts it up. Hodges can't quite get there. Gee, there's water coming up. Slips it out to Buckley. Buckley towards goal, and the kick is a shocker. Gee, well, even Buckley can't kick them at the moment. And I don't think anyone was more surprised than Rouvray when he took them up.
It was Murphy, in fact. You're right, Daisy. As the ball goes out, Christie is there. Callahan gets in there. And what would be going through the minds of some of these Tiger players at the moment?
Well, I think they'd just be remembering, particularly the Marshalls and Seabones and company, of all the grand finals they've been in and just how many they've lost. Only four in the history of the club. Two of them 84-85 under Corns. But they just cannot beat this Magpie side.
There's not a lot they can do except keep their body over the ball and keep trying and walk out with their head high, because they're going to be beaten today, and they're going to be beaten badly by the look of it. Jamison in there. They're still having a go as the handball goes out towards Murphy. He's waiting for some movement, eventually drops in a short pass. Perhaps not the best option, but no one was moving. In there is Buckley. He dived in there. He may have caught one high. He's down on the ground, and he's up again. So the youngster's okay. He had a big day. Kicked 2 goals. He's had 20 kicks and only 1 handball. But he doesn't give the statisticians too much work as far as handballs are concerned. But when you're as skillful as him, you normally can get the kick away.
There's not too many teammates can actually run off him. He usually runs past them.
Yeah, fair point. We're well into time on. We're at the 29-minute mark as the ball goes up towards centre-half forward for the Tigers. It's fisted away, picked up by Mansell. One gets the feeling a lot of these players didn't pack 2 pairs of boots today. They may not have heard the weather report. There was always going to be rain late this afternoon or this evening as the ball is over the boundary line. And the golden rule for all those youngsters, you take your moulded soles and your screw-ins, and that's what would be required at the moment, the old screw-in spritz. 43 plays 93. The Pies lead by 50 points. Missed away by Chalmers. Ball goes out towards Lamb. Can't control it. Nor can Williams. He's still in there. And the boundary line wins out once more.
Close to three-quarter time. 15-3 to 6-7. Can you believe that Port Adelaide have kicked 15 goals, 3 in this weather? Unbelievable accuracy. As the boys have told you, Scott Hodges, 6 kicks and 6 goals. Rowan Smith back towards the half back line. I think the umpire's going to give a free kick there, and that'll go the way of the Bays, Graham Christie. Almost 30 minutes gone. Looks horribly bleak out there. 7th kick to Christie. Chalmers has had his measure on the day, but Christie's done some useful work. The Bays have simply just been not in the event at any stage. Out goes Lamb. Siren sounds. And at three-quarter time, it's Port Adelaide by 50 points.
Well, it's been a very disappointing quarter for the Tigers. But for Port Adelaide, seven goals without a miss they added from their 21-point advantage at half-time. And Glenelg only managed to kick a couple, and that was Clayton Lamb and John Fidge. I think the disappointing thing from Kim Hodgman's point of view is that with the rain and the difficult conditions, it really didn't come back to height or pace or power. It really came back to desire. And Port Adelaide have just stripped Glenelg of all of that.
So at three-quarter time, Port Adelaide in command here and in control on 15 goals, 3, 93 over the Tigers on 6, 7, 43. We'll be back to see what the final term holds for us then. It's three-quarter time here at Football Park, and it's a sad and sorry sight for Glenelg supporters. They trail badly on 6 goals, 7, 43. Port Adelaide in total control on 15 goals, 3, 93.
These are the goal kickers. Hodges magnificent with 6. Darren Smith fantastic at centre-half forward with 3. Buckley 2. Setri Foster, Chalmers, Ball Ace, and for Glenelg, Fidges Battlehard with 3. Salisbury, Mansell and Kretschmer 1.
Well, let's take a look at some of the highlights. And firstly, John Fidge, who he's caused a few problems, but he's just been starved of opportunities today.
Yes, well, that was a fantastic mark just after the half-time break, and he just sort of really went all three-quarter time. Oh, I thought he pulled a bit of a hamstring there, but it was a great take, Kimbo, and it was a much-needed goal.
And a man that also really lifted his game in that term was Darren Smith.
He certainly did. Like, Darren Smith has been around, and he's just been... Look at the way he puts his body out. Puts out the one hand, the left hand, and a beautiful goal from Port Adelaide. Yes, a very good goal.
He's a fine player. He's much maligned at times, Aaron Smith, but he certainly knows how to produce the football when it counts, and he's been an ornament to the Port Adelaide Football Club, and he plays a very fair brand of football, and he really can do some incredibly skillful things at times.
Well, he can finish off the play, Kibbo, can't he? In that particular goal there, he ran away and just kicked a nice goal.
There is just something about Port Adelaide in grand finals. They grow another leg. Let's take a look at Scott Hodges. He's just had what you'd call a fairly useful day. 6 kicks and 6 goals.
Well, he started magnificently, and beautiful finish off play.
So there we have it. Port Adelaide in control. We're at three-quarter time. The final term's about to start. We lost Graham Campbell. We believe he's floating down a storm drain somewhere. So if you see him, grab him for us.
Well, he'll still be talking, Kimbo. Hey, you'll hear him.
It is now back to Ian Day.
Touché. I think I can see some bubbles. His head's underwater. And I can tell you, with authority, the drought has broken. 15-3 to 6-7. Kim Hodges didn't waste a lot of time out there at three-quarter time. I don't know what he could say. The final quarter, Port Adelaide by 50 points. They kicked a marvellous 7 goals without a miss in that rain bucketing down in the third quarter. So that's super footy. Chigwidden gives it away to Kretschmer. Thompson off the side of his boot somewhat, but finds Mansell, and the umpire is not going to pay the mark. It must have been smothered, and they're going to ball it up centre field. Kim, no, not Kim, I'll go to Neville. What would have Kim Hodgman said to the players at three-quarter time when you're in for a belting or hiding to nothing?
Well, I think he would have been pretty critical of their effort and endurance and just commitment of the footy, but more than anything, just for pride, outscore them in the final quarter.
Getting underneath the football up there. Fidge can't take it at the bottom of the pack. Is Hallahan, and the umpire will ball up inside 50.
I know that a couple of coaches have been known to say things about what you remember in grand finals is how you pick your side for the next season, and it's very true of players. It really it shows the character and the courage of players to see how they finish these games off.
Kretschmer, Hallahan, certainly the Bay's best players have been their smaller ones. Kretschmer comes into the action, tumbles one in towards the half forward line. Fidge behind the pack, tries to get it away. Delaney's there, Rizonico over the top. And the umpire says throw it in adjacent to the behind post. No question, Mansell and Hallahan have probably been the two best for the Bays. And McKay has done some very useful work on the half back line. Chalmers gives it away now to Geneva. Foster, it was looking dishevelled out towards centre wing. Setri with a chance. He goes to the line with him, his bow. Well, that's a lot of courage. Visca, it was. Now Setri kicks it out of play, and that's out on the full.
I don't know whether it, in actual fact, it was. I thought it went along the ground, but certainly the Port Adelaide small men doing a lot more than the Mansells and Chigwidden in focus at the moment. They've simply been outplayed in this last couple of quarters.
as Marshall gets a kick away. He's been fairly quiet this afternoon. He was thrashed in the first term. He's picked up 10 kicks as Abernathy tried to crash his way through. It's taken by Chigwin. The handball out to Hallahan. He was under pressure when receiving the ball. Phillips couldn't get down to it, but little George is there to help him out. And likewise, Roger. They're never far away from each other. And Roger Delaney clears with a mammoth kick to the outer side. Bartlett's onto the ground. Loose ball. He'll be there first. Picked up by Kretschmer. Thought about a couple of options. Now decides to kick. I think he'll kick anyway. Eventually drives it in long. Lamb is there. And he couldn't take the mark. Play on the court. It's a race for pace between Phillips and Fidge. And big Coochie. Well, the ball's not out. I think Coochie won that one.
And it's worth mentioning Greg Phillips' age and legs and inability to run quickly were mentioned today. But it hasn't been a factor. The 33-year-old, he stands 188 centimetres tall and 91 kgs. He really reads everything beautifully, and he certainly have done his job today.
Have a look at that. The rain continues to come down at Footy Park, and I think we're in for more yet. At the throw-in over the top, Chalmers only as far as Rubenick smothered. Biachi's going to have to work hard against Hallahan. That's holding the ball, but the umpire didn't see it, and you can't guess him. Not if you're an umpire of Michael Abbott's class. A throw-in, left full forward pocket. John Cale sitting down in the bunker. I think he's probably as relaxed as John Cale can be when he's coaching. As I've said many times, he seems to age before your eyes. Salisbury through. With him is Ginova. Back in defence, it's Rosonico. Heaves it back towards the half-back line. Thompson's up there. Christie's going to have to work a gallop. Abernathy, Mansell, Rubenick. Gee, it's hard work to try to pick up the football. Seabone gets it across to Marshall. Still can't get a clear kick away. Salisbury at the bottom of the pack. Marshall off the desk. Arms and legs everywhere. And what does an umpire do when there's all that around? He's just got to bounce the football.
And it looks like Danny Hughes might get a run to the applause of the Port Adelaide people. But Glenelg really making a commitment now. A bigger commitment than they made in that third term. And Nathan Buckley seems to be carrying an injury in the lower region, Kim.
Test of strength there. Fidge did it well. There's the soccer, and Fidge bangs through his fourth goal. He outbodied Delaney then, had the loose ball and banged it through. And Delaney points to the scoreboard, and I think John told him he wasn't all impressed by that comment. Nevertheless, Fidge has done pretty well today.
Yes, he's playing his 52nd game with the Tigers, and that was his 256th goal. So 26-year-old forward is... It's been a vocal point for Glenelg, and was shouldered with the responsibility of almost winning this grand final single-handedly.
At the bounce, it is Hughes gets the tap away. Mansell to the outer side. McKay's going to be first there as Hutton goes in pursuit. McKay off the deck. In towards Lamb. Lamb will need running support from there. No, gets around. Goes to the half-forward line and finds John Seabone, who, as Kim told you, has gone to centre-half forward. Intercepted by Buckley. It was meant for Rubenick. Buckley did it again. He seemed to be over his injury. Down on the lower part of the stomach. Wouldn't have been all that handy. 21 kicks. Bartlett. Oh, raises a gallop. Comes off the half-back line. Drives halfway up towards the half-forward line. Fiachi can't find it. Chigwidden and Fiachi. And the umpire's got to ball it up. Going to be a long last quarter for the Bay supporters. If they're still here, of course. Most of them would be. 15-3 to 7-7. I won't say they get used to getting beaten by Port Adelaide, but they've had a bit of practice at it in grand finals. And for what it's worth, a side who's down at half-time hasn't won the grand final since 1978. Hardly a stat that's applicable today, but it is a stat. Williams can't get it through. Jamison looks for it, and the umpire once again will have to ball it up.
We've had just over 6 minutes of the final term. That youngster looking a little wet. Doesn't look that happy at the moment. So I would suggest he supports the Tigers. As the ball is punched wide and Northeast punches it wider, it goes out towards Abernathy. Kretschmer is there, close to the boundary line, right in front of that West End super sign. Not a bad drop, and I would imagine quite a deal of that will be consumed this evening by players from both sides.
done by you and me with a bit of luck, Kim. But the stats to three-quarter time, 218 possessions each. So Glenelg have had as much of the football as Port Adelaide, just simply unable to use it as effectively. And 18 shots at goal to 14. So Miles, there's a almost 50 points between them. There's only five shots at goal. So you've got to give credit where it's due. Port Adelaide much more efficient and decisive when they've got the ball.
And Jennifer's got it at the moment as he puts his side forward. It goes out towards Borlase, but once again, the boundary line wins out. I mentioned before, Daisy, in 1990 in the grand final between these two sides, Hodges kicked 6-5. Well, he already has six today. And in that other grand final, as I mentioned, 1990, Fidge kicked 5-3. Well, he's kicked 4-3 so far.
Hodges has done extremely well. I still can't believe that Port Adelaide can kick 15 goals free in this weather. Superb kicking. Thompson gets it back towards the half-back line. Northeast can't. Clayton Lamb-Kayan, he drives long up towards Delaney, and that's a fine defensive mark. He'll play on. Rowan Smith provides the run out at centre wing. Well put. He'll also play on now, looking for an option. Brown's in the pocket, and Port Adelaide can do no wrong. The way they're playing, you think they'd have webbed feet. They just seem to be gliding over the turf, and Brown will shoot from about 30.
Well, they look like they turned the sprinklers on at Alberton during the week, as you said, Daisy, doing it pretty easy at the moment in difficult conditions.
Eight kicks, eight handballs to David Brown, and he's just put another nail in.
Port Adelaide 16-3, Glenelg 7-7, so it's still a 50-point advantage at the nine-minute mark to the Magpies. I'm not sure, I think it's their 31st premiership this will be, as Bartlett kicks out wide. Gee, that's not bad. My poor old Eagles, I think they've got three, I stand corrected. Might be four. I know our last one was in 1953. Glenelg only have four, so you cannot question the fact that Port Adelaide, if anyone ever did, have been South Australia's premier football club. As a Glenelg player slips over, the ball now goes out towards Rubinick. Thought about feeding off, decides to dispose of the ball with a kick out wide to Marshall. He thought about a handball, chips out a short pass, and Lamb drops it. And then a big day, Clayton Lamb, as Northeast punches the ball forward, and it goes out towards Mansell. He's tried hard. Recruited from Panola. A cheerio to our viewers down in Mount Gambier with SES 8, as Hughes went through solidly, and Fidge falls on top of Hughes. And those two exchange pleasantries in round 17, and Danny Hughes came out of it second best.
And John Carl, over 13 years, has been in eight grand finals. He's won seven, lost one, and you can add another one today.
Certainly a marvellous record. Lamb in towards the forward pocket. Delaney's got plenty of time. Fidge there with him, and the ball is out of play on the left full forward pocket. The forlorn scene in the bay bunker, not a lot to get excited about. 10 metres around from the behind post. Rowan Smith, running player is northeast, back towards centre field. Ball A, he's tried to get it out, or Hutton it was, off the deck. He's going to get a free kick. Hasn't had a big afternoon, David Hutton. Eight kicks and one handball. This man has a brilliant afternoon. And must be well up, if not a lay-down was there for the medal, as he drives up towards the half forward line. Over the back now, it's Duthie. Duthie goes for the safety of the line. Bartlett's got a lumber after it. Quickly in with Smith, but I don't think Bartlett was too worried about whether he kept it in play or not.
And Port Adelaide have a phenomenal record in the SANFL since 1897. The number of times they've finished further down the list than fifth you could count on one hand. And I think at the moment, John Carl probably chasing Foss Williams' record over 21 years as coach. He won 10 premierships and only lost seven, but he finished third three times as well and sixth once. So an incredible performance by Port Adelaide as Jamison leaves the ground.
Lyndon Bow back onto the arena. We know that Jamison has been very ill in recent weeks with a severe bout of the flu. Does look a little bit thinner. It was reported he lost about a stone. It's a lot of weight if it's true. As the handball goes out towards Mansell, Mansell kicks wide and in turn puts it out to Rubinick, who's tried hard against Rowan Smith. We'll get the stats on those two players. Rubinick's had 10 and 7. Smith's 7 and 8. Perhaps 11 and 8, I should say. So pretty even on that wing. As Duthie puts it in, and the mark's been taken there by Abernathy. Who these Port boys are going to enjoy tonight. Greg Phillips, Mark Williams certainly playing his last game. He'll give the old Coca-Cola a hiding. 16 kicks for Abbott. Not his best one. Went straight back to Rubinick. Has to get around Buckley. Did it quite well. Drops in a short pass to find Mansell. As I said, he's tried hard, Mansell. We're at the 12 and a half minute mark. Mansell with kick number 23. Picks out big Coochie Phillips. I tell you, the Lighthouse Hotel will do a roaring trade for the next couple of weeks as he hambles out towards Delaney.
Hutton's out there. With him is Visca. And I think he's given away a free kick. David Hutton comes back centre field. Ball A's. Port Adelaide into attack again. Now, who will he look for? Off goes Mark Williams. Hodges doesn't bother to give a lead. Ball A's goes to the outer side to give Darren Smith the run of the football. Who needs support from there as Bartlett closes. But he takes the ball out of play in that spot.
Simply going through the motions now, Glenelg, but certainly they're committed. They're still playing hard football, but in their minds they know they're beaten, and that's a very hard thing to do.
Still, Port Adelaide hasn't kicked a point until the early part of the second quarter. Even in these conditions, Ball A's can't. Seabohm off the turf. Quickly in Rubinick. Just as quickly he went out, Lamb under pressure. Port Adelaide have been superb in the tackling department this afternoon. Fiachi goes out. Rubinick comes out with a football. Now what can the Bay set up? Out wide, he gets a lead. That's beautifully put. And finds Salisbury. Oh, Scooter runs on and runs into trouble. And he's asked to play on. Foster. Brazonico. Northeast. Hard to pick them up out there. Abba. Well, these fellas have all played in Melbourne, so they'll be used to these conditions. Brown. Slips it back now to Abba, who kicks to the half-forward line. Out there is Jennifer. Close to the line. Will he keep it in? No, he can't. And it's a throw-in on the half-forward left flank for Port Adelaide.
I cannot believe in these conditions that Port Adelaide have not kicked a point since the early stages of the second quarter. So that is nearly two and a half quarters of football. They've only kicked 3 points for the game.
Yes, and they've managed to add something like 8 straight goals since their last point. An incredible effort and very accurate.
And have a look at that. Mansell then, he was gone for all money. Wasn't a vigorous attempt to get rid of the ball, and Williams knew that, got the free kick, and he's popped in the pass to find David Hutton. One of the true gentlemen of the game, Stephen Williams, started off very scratchy. He was banished to the bench. He's about to come back out onto the oval. Mark Williams. Oh, Fiachi looking very proppy. The 1990 Jack Oatey medalist. Fiachi leaves the ground for Stephen Williams. Hutton slipped over as he disposed of the football. And a free kick's been picked out and will go the way of Paul Rouvray. And Fiachi not looking good.
No, he looks like it looks like it's cramp. It doesn't look like the sort of injury that he's protecting. It's either set in or it's a knee or an ankle. But anyway, George can soak up the glory now. They've got another one.
I reckon the rot's probably set in this weather. David Brown off the side of his boot. Rouvray comes to meet it. Should clear. Great shepherding by Bartlett at the back. Puts it out in front of Rubinick. He's really fought hard. He's going to run a dead heat. In goes Foster. Rubinick stood his ground and the ball is out of play. Not sure whether George has got pulled a hamstring. He looked like he was walking with cramp. But he might have just gone off because they're not in any danger at the moment. Hallahan off the side of his boot. 17th kick goes to the half forward line. Bow over the top of Stephen Williams, and the umpire will bounce at centre wing.
Well, I guess we have to spare a thought for Scotty Salisbury, 34 years of age. He's calling it a game, a day, after 241 games for the Tiger. He's been an inspiration at times, suffered a lot of injuries, and been a state player with a lot of pride.
Out of play on the half forward line. When you're looking for excuses for the Bays, and certainly it's hard to find any, but when that gusty wind blew up late in that third quarter, it really blew hard before the storm set in. Port Adelaide got 3 or 4 valuable goals into time on. The Bays couldn't even get the ball above ground level when they went into attack. And, of course, then the rain came and Port Adelaide simply has been too strong, too brilliant in these conditions. Salisbury looks for it and Hughes puts it out of play.
Nearly 17 minutes into the final term. Port Adelaide 16-3, Glenelg 7-7. Not a lot can be said about the Tigers. You must just compliment the marvellous effort that these Port boys have put in. and also the coaching staff as the ball goes down towards Geneva. Quick kick away. Such a tight unit. The Deadshead family down at Alberton. And let's hope John Seabone's not too badly hurt there. He hasn't hardly moved at all. And it could be his last game, and it would be tragic to cop an injury. Annie Hughes apparently went through pretty solidly, and Seabone was on the end of it. So he's up and running, but I'm not sure if he knows where he's running. He's more or less going around in circles, John Seabone, as Northeast comes out with the football and Stephen Williams takes a mark. And John Seabone looks very disorientated at the moment. I'm not sure who he has to pick up. Let's hope he's okay. It may be best to get him off the ground. I don't think he'll want to come off, though. Very proud man. He's been a fantastic footballer, recruited from Mount Burr. The ball hits the ground. McKay is there. He comes from Lucendale. Darren Smith. Number of country players out there. And there's Siebes, looking a little nonplussed at the moment.
I'm sure he's had some belts around the head before, or I'm suggesting that was what happened there, but body's taken some punishment in its time. But the real secret to Port, other than, I guess, Scott Hodges' great performance, has been their half-back line and their defence generally. It's been absolutely impervious today.
42,242 people have come to Footy Park to see Port Adelaide win the 1992 Grand Final. Salisbury got leg, but got out of it pretty well. Slips it over and out of Seabone. Let's see if he can find himself. Looks for Fidge on the lead. Northeast. Delaney will provide the shepherd. Northeast got time to look out wide. Chance for Port to run it out through Borlase. There's no pressure put on him at all as Borlase goes through the centre line, kicks long. Out in front of Abernethy, with him is Duthie. Abber needs support. He goes back to David Hutton, in looking for Hodges, but the kick is too far, and Rouvray will run out of defence. Or he tried to run out, he slipped out of defence, but regained his composure well, and finds Salisbury, who lost it. Buckley, gee, the water's almost up over their knees. Stephen Williams, on the lead now is Smith. He can't find it either. And the ball is out of play. Well, this is probably the finest surface in Australia, and even that's got water on it.
Well, it started raining after half-time, and it has simply not stopped. It's bucketed down here at Football Park, and obviously there's nothing laying around on the surface. The ball is very slippery, and the players are finding it very difficult to keep their feet.
Smith did well to hook that one back, but once more the ball is out of play. And we hope our country viewers have enjoyed this game. If you're a Port Adelaide supporter, you certainly would. And those country viewers include SES 8 Mount Gambier, GDS 4 Port Pirie, GDS 5 Port Lincoln, RTS 5A in the Riverland, and BKN 7 at Broken Hill. As the ball is passed out, and what a breeding ground for footballers the country regions have been. As the Tigers go forward again, Phillips back there. Well, he could have taken a specky, but he wanted to thump it towards the boundary line. He missed it. You won't be overly concerned about that. The ball, I thought it may have been out of play. According to the crowd, I think it was. The umpire was caught napping. Seabone has the football. Plays on. I don't think he's 100% at the moment, John Seabone. He won't stop trying. Mark Williams has the football. Rubinick from behind. Smith in front. Very clever side, Port Adelaide. Oh, Williams slips over. So too Rubinick. And he gets a free kick for a trip. Plays on quickly with a handball out to Salisbury. Hasn't had a lot of the football. He puts it out wide. Five kicks, five handballs. Fidge falls over. He got rid of Delaney and slipped over himself. And the crowd have given Johnny Fidge a really rough time today as Delaney drops in a short pass and finds Geneva. Geneva out to Delaney. The crowd want him to kick a goal. Roger the Dodger. He goes long looking for Hodges. Hodges couldn't get up there in these heavy conditions. Over the top is Christie. Loose ball. It goes out to Rouvray. In turn, the handball finds McKay. McKay with a bit of a worm burner. Puts it out in turn out in the direction of Kretschmer. Fidge is out there. The handball goes to Hallahan. He fumbles. He'll have to go back to Kretschmer, which he does. He takes plenty of time. Puts the ball on the ground. Umpire having a good look there. That's the boundary umpire. Lamb drops one. Hasn't had a big day. The handball now goes in towards Williams, in turn to Delaney, back towards, who is that, Borlase? It is. And they've been given a free kick, not a lot in that one. Daisy can't believe it. And I think umpire Michael Abbott is just feeling a little sorry for Scott Salisbury.
Darren Manswell will get a free kick for a push in the back. Purely academic at the moment. And the Daisy that couldn't believe it is the one out there, not the one up here. Darren Manswell to send the Bays into attack. 25 kicks and 11 handballs. He's certainly done his part for the Bays. The umpire said play on northeast. Marshall thought it was the mark, as did Sean Seabohm earlier on. Rouvray, he's done pretty well despite the fact that Hodges has kicked six goals. He's had a lot more opportunities. Bow comes off the half-back line, gets it out wide. He got it from Rubinick. Now McKay through. Great smother there by Hughes. Going through Buckley. Now Mark Williams. Out wide his brother Stephen. Rowan Smith, the runner. Now he's going to come back inside looking for someone, but no one's available. Visca. Gee. Made hard work of that. Kicks up towards the half-forward line. Northeast is up there. No question. Port Adelaide have handled the slippery ball far better than the Bays. Off the side of his boot, Rosonico. He looks clagged out there. He can hardly scratch himself. As Stephen Williams comes back, he's got to have to scratch himself now. Gets another kick. Kicks this one in towards the half forward line. I can tell you out there, it's absolute dead set slow motion.
Well, it's almost impossible to keep your feet or change direction if any one time. But the players, I would be very interested if it was a closer game, how they'd have managed these conditions. But at the moment, Glenelg have picked one goal this quarter and so have Port. So it's been a pretty even contest this quarter.
The ball now taken by Buckley. The handball over the top was an unorthodox one, but it found Abernathy. Abba steadies from about 52 metres out. Hodges, a big leap. Had to apply the spoil. Loose ball. Jennifer would like to snap one, and I think he has. Well, was it touch? No, it's a goal.
Of course, they enjoyed it.
17-3-7-7. Still can't believe it. Still Port Adelaide haven't managed a point since the early part of that second quarter. Christie against Hughes, who gets the tap away. Borlase gets it over to Darren Smith. The runner out there is Browns. Had a good game. Through goes Bartlett's got to go chase it. Stephen Williams will get it there first. And he's quite happy to see it go out on the outer side. Looks like it was just cramp because George has got a smile on his face, as well he might. Port Adelaide through and through, and what a great player he's been for them over the years. Mark Williams up over the top, but a free has been given to John Seabohm at centre wing. Port Adelaide have had some super players in the wet out there. Jennifer, Delaney, Chalmers, Hodges, Brown, of course Buckley probably best on ground, and so it goes on. And their defence has stood up remarkably well, and this man who's come in has played a fine game at centre-half, or on the half-back flank.
Indeed he has, and Jim Hodgman told me before the game that Tony Simons has retired today, and he announced that to the reserves before the game, so it's the when there's the Premiership Cup, and that's exactly what Port Adelaide will receive after the game, but possibly some retirements. Clayton Lamb will have to think about his future. David Marshall might give it away. Chris Duthie, Scott Salisbury for the Tigers, and definitely for Port Adelaide, Mark Williams' last game. Danny Hughes will think about it, and so too will Greg Phillips.
Rowan Smith gave it to David Brown. We're into time on in the 1992 Grand Final. Christie's tried very hard. He couldn't get down to that one. Settry tried to kick it off the ground. Bartlett's there. He does likewise, more effectively, though, and it goes out towards Mansell. So little Nige, recruited from Panola, puts the ball out wide with his 26th kick, and he's been the Tigers' best, I would say. And there'll only be about perhaps 30 seconds to a minute remaining in this final term. We've only had three goals kicked, so we'll have to start thinking about the Jack Oatey medalist, and I'd put my money on number 34 for the Magpies.
Oh, well, I think he's as sure as he was of getting the medal, the Magarey medal, of getting the Jack Oatey medal. But whilst we think it's been an absolute slaughter, and I guess the scoreboard says it is, Kim, 56 points, but they've only had something like six more shots, and but no more possessions around the ground. So it's a credit to Port Adelaide how they've managed the ball around the field.
Yeah, well, John Cale's mentioned that before. They are constantly outgunned in the handball department, but like he said, they don't mind as long as they win on the scoreboard. And, well, they play a very effective, and I suppose you could call it old-fashioned type of game. It's get the football, give it to someone, and win the game. And that's what they have done in the 1992 Grand Final. They were far too strong for Glenelg. 17-3. To the Tigers, 7-7.
That would have to be the greatest performance by Port Adelaide side.
Yes, every grand final sweet, but I think after last year, to win this year, it was great.
It didn't matter
whether it was windy or wet or dry. We were just totally committed, and old tired legs, I mean, it gives us a lot of pleasure to know that the courageous Mark Williams, Stephen Williams, Greg Phillips, they lack pace, but they put their body over the ball, so I'm really pleased.
We may not see see a few of those, John, but they've been fantastic.
I said before the start of the game in the pre-match speech, Rick, that the one thing I spoke to each player individually in the room, and the two things I had to say about Greg Phillips and Mark Williams was that in the future, if they ask me the best teams, those two players will be in my best teams ever.
John, you can never go against Port Adelaide. Port Adelaide against the rest of Australia, they keep on coming up trumps, don't they?
Oh, well, we're pleased, and I'd like to congratulate Glenelg because it's very hard after 6 days, and I know how hard it is, so, you know, they're worthy opponents.
You won't mind getting wet.
No.
Well done, John.
Thanks,
fantastic.
Thank
Welcome back to Football Park, and look at the elation on a number of those players. And we see with the shirt on there, Mark Tyler. He'd be very happy for his team, but he must be hurting inside. He kicked 97 goals for the season. He helped his side get there, and he wasn't out there today. And talking of emotion, look at Nathan Buckley. He's overwhelmed at the moment.
Well, he's had an overwhelming season. He's only a youngster, 20 years of age. He got 22 kicks today and 3 handball. He's certainly my pick for the Jack Oatey Medal, as the crowd showed the zoo to congratulate the Magpies.
Ladies and gentlemen, the SNFL president, Mr. Max Bashir, will now announce the winner of the 1992 Jack Oatey Medal for the best player in today's grand final. And Mr. Jack Oatey will present the medal to the winner.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the Jack Oatey Medal for the best player in this year's grand final is Nathan Buckley.
Now we've got the mic. I'd just like to thank those blokes there. They're a great bunch of blokes. It's been a hard year. We've worked hard for this. And by God, we deserve it. Thanks a lot.
Mr. Bashir now will present the premiership medallions to the Port Adelaide team as they are called up onto the dais. Firstly, number 2 for Port Adelaide, Tim Genevieve. Number 4, George Fiacci. Number 5, Bruce Abernethy. Number 7, Roger Delaney. Number 8, Brett Chalmers. Number 9, Mark Williams.
Thanks a lot. Happy birthday, Mark.
Number 10, Stephen Williams. Number 11, Scott Hodges. Number 13, Rowan Smith. Number 16, Darryl Borlase. Number 17, Paul Rosonico. Number 19, Adrian Setri. Number 21, David Brown. Number 25, Danny Hughes. Number 26, Richard Foster. Number 27, David Hutton. Number 28, Darren Smith. Number 32, Paul Northeast. Number 34.
United, United! We're back at number one!
Number one, Greg Phillips, captain of Port Adelaide. And the coach of the 1992 Premiers, John Cahill.
Ladies and gentlemen, before I present the Thomas Seymour Hill Cup, may I say that this match brings to an end another outstanding season for the South Australian National Football League. When the Adelaide Football Club entered a team into the AFL competition 2 years ago, we decided that we would make our competition the next best competition for the AFL and that our league would be the best state league in Australia. We believe that in 1992, we've gone a long way towards proving that because our Till Cup side were runners-up in the championships. We defeated Western Australia here and we won the State of Origin match here against Victoria. I congratulate both Glenelg and Port Adelaide on reaching the finals, and Port Adelaide deserved their win. They're an outstanding team, and congratulations to Port Adelaide Football Club. I have much pleasure in presenting the Thomas Seymour Hill Cup to Greg Phillips, the captain of Port Adelaide.
I must back up the words of Nathan Buckley. The boys have worked tremendously hard this year to redeem themselves from the last year. We were disappointed, but with all the training staff, John Cale, all the committee, everyone involved at the Port Adelaide Football Club and the supporters, we thank for your support throughout the year, and this is yours. Your duty.
Buckley, will you come and get your medal, please? Nathan.
We now ask the Port Adelaide Football Club to do the traditional lap of honour.
Well, there you have it, Port Adelaide Football Club, the Premiers for 1992, and you must admire Port Adelaide. They're a magnificent club, and you must feel for players like Greg Phillips too. In the twilight of his career as captain, it's a big honour for him today.
If we can pick up Greg, because he's still around the podium, and indeed he's getting all his kids under the ground. He's got a lot of them too. He's got a bit of a family, and it might indicate that this might be his last game here for Port Adelaide. The last time we see him, let's hope it's not, but if it is, what a magnificent way for that man to go out of football. And Port Adelaide, as I said, after half-time, Kim, the conditions were the same. Well, there's four kids there. They've obviously got a friend sleeping over for the night. But Port Adelaide just too tough in what I call equal conditions. I mean, the player that wanted the ball the most in these conditions gets it, and that's a trait of theirs. They're a very cohesive lot of players. They love each other, they love their club, they love their coach, and they're all very important elements. They mean as much as skill and balance in your selection.
Well, tremendous camaraderie with the Magpies. They just congratulated their cheer squad for being such great supporters over the year. A marvellous effort. Premiers for 1992 and for the 31st time, Port Adelaide. One feels for Glenelg, but they were nowhere near good enough today.
And welcome back to Football Park, and very jubilant scenes here with the Port Adelaide players doing their lap of honour.
the 1992 Premiers, and they've certainly deserved their victory, Graham Campbell. They were magnificent today.
And Ken, doesn't that show you how football clubs never tire of winning premierships? Port have won four of the last five now,
yep.
And yet each one is something special for them, and the players revel in victory. It's amazing.
Well, they're a very proud club, Graham, and they never say die. Today, when Glenelg got away to a good start, one got the impression that perhaps the Bays may take the game up to Port Adelaide, but for the 19-minute mark of that second quarter, when the game had to be won, it was Port Adelaide.
Yeah, they had an assurance about themselves, Ken. I think they knew the tide would turn,
yep.
And the Glenelg club winning the toss was an important toss to win. Gave them a chance to get away to a good start. First goal off the ground,
yes,
by Darren Manswell, and Fidge joined in. And all of a sudden, it was on for young and old, and it seesawed a bit up to, as you said, midway through the second term. Then out of the blue, Scotty Hodges kicked three goals, and the game got away from them.
It's an amazing situation. They are a unique club, Graham, as much that, you know, they just love winning. They love winning premierships, and after last year being bundled out in the elimination final by West Adelaide. Well, it hurt the Port Adelaide club, and they set about their task of turning that right around, and not too many clubs would have been able to do that the way that Port Adelaide have done it.
And it must be said, Ken, they did it with only two new players. I know they were important people.
Yep.
In Nathan Buckley, the Magarey medalist, and Brett Chalmers, who has been a tower of strength all year in the ruck. But that's only two different people to what was an unaspiring side last year.
Well, it was called a slow side last year, Graham.
They are relatively slow, Ken. The ball moves quickly, yeah.
But they keep winning, right?
There's no leg speed in many of their players. Rowan Smith's quick. Buckley himself is quick.
Yep.
You can't say the Rovers are super speed players in Tim Ginniver and Adrian Setre. And the other guy who fills it as a Rover, David Brown, they aren't what you call super quick. But they have a great belief in themselves, and they have persistence. That's the thing I said at half time.
Their
persistence made something out of nothing sometimes.
And Nathan Buckley, Graham, capped off a marvellous year by being named the Jack Oatey Medal winner. He's had a marvellous year, hasn't he?
Well, you couldn't argue that, Ken. Usually you can say, well, it could have been so-and-so. It could have been... Everyone's choice was Nathan Buckley. He just defied the odds today and just kept getting kick after kick. I know he wasn't tagged, and that will always be, I guess, a question of whether Kim Hodgson should have done that or not. Nonetheless, the man may be untaggable. Is that a word?
Well, it sounds okay, Graham. Graham, from the Bay's point of view, they were in the game, as I said, until the 19-minute mark of the second quarter. Where did they lose the plot? Was it just taken away by Port Adelaide?
I said, Ken, persistence, I believe.
Yes.
I think Glenelg, in their heart of hearts, would have thought they had a winning chance. You've got to think that way, Ken. You can't go to any game saying, oh, well, you know, they've had a week's rest, more than we've had, and things don't look like going our way. And the persistence of Port just brushed them aside in the finish. In
okay.
The final analysis, Port just wanted the game so badly it happened for them.
They certainly do. OK, let's now take it down to the very jubilant Port Adelaide rooms.
Jack Oatey medal, a Magarey medal and a premiership all in 1 year. What else can you do, my friend?
Oh, I can just praise the blokes. It's just, they've made me what I am. I mean, I put in the hard work, but without these blokes, nothing like this is possible.
In your first grand final, were you all nervous this morning, or
no,
were you pretty well settled down?
I don't get nervous. If I'm nervous, I don't play well. And the first three quarters, I thought really good. I think they must have gone to sleep the last quarter.
Well, Jack wanted to really kick with the breeze, but Port Adelaide put up such a great effort in that first quarter into the breeze.
Yeah, I thought they had 80% of the ball, and in the first 15, we weren't hitting the ball very hard, but in the last 15 we did, and I think that proved fruits.
Nathan, at the 20-minute mark of that second quarter, the storm started, it really started to gust up. Do you think Port Adelaide got helped by that, because you kicked four quick ones, including that magnificent one of yours into the open goal?
Oh, I don't know if it was that good, but...
It looked great from the back of the stand.
I'm happy with it then, it's just a great thing to win.
Can we show those to our viewers out there? Nathan Buckley, congratulations. A marvellous effort.
Thanks a lot.
Well, Mark Williams, what a fantastic game of football.
Yeah, it really was a hard game. We knew that they'd come out fighting in the first quarter, and if we could withstand that, we thought with their 6 days rest, we'd take over, and, you know, I think that's what happened.
What about the conditions?
Yeah, we had everything, didn't we? It was real hot early, and then you had to convert, change your boots and really get in with their wet weather footy. And, you know, all throughout the time, I think Port had played well in wet weather, and we really kicked away then and showed that, you know, we might be slow, we might be old, but we were too good today.
Yeah, well, it certainly was, and Glenelg didn't give them much of a fight after half-time. But to yourself, a fantastic way to end your football career.
Yeah, I tell you, I was thinking all week, I'm going to have to mark the last ball and kick the winning goal or something, but it was a lot easier winning by 10 goals. And really, I have to thank the other guys for doing most of the work, because I really felt that, I got a pretty good ride there today.
Well, of course, everything else, everyone's against Port Adelaide, and they really came through. The Magarey medalist, the Jack Oatey medalist, the the goal kicker, everything, and the premiership to finish it off.
Yeah, as I said throughout the year, last year everyone was real disappointed about the AFL thing, but we had to focus, and probably 6 weeks ago we were intending to play this game, and it probably took us a long time to get our minds on the job to actually perform on this day, and we were waiting for a long time, as I said, and we didn't let anyone down.
Congratulations, and go and enjoy the celebration.
Thanks, mate. Thanks a lot.
Was that... Hey, who are you talking to? You're supposed to be talking to our Channel 9 viewers out there. Bloody Timmy eight. Geneva, four grand finals. You must be getting used to it.
Yes, four premierships now, mate. I tell you what, you don't get used to it, because I come in here before the game, and I tell you what, I had to go to talk about 20 times, mate. I'll shoot myself.
Can I just turn that side? What's that on there? That's not lipstick, is it?
Yeah, no. Mate, you know what it's like, mate. Stud yourself.
Timmy, did you think it was going to be not that easy, but did you think you were going to win by that much?
No, I didn't, mate, especially the way the Bays opened. They had a plan, obviously, to go to it straight away, and, we hadn't had a lot of football in the past 6 weeks, so we sort of struggled a bit to get it going. But I knew in that second quarter, we just started to do those things that win finals, get the ball going and that sort of thing. We knew we had the leg power on them because of the week's rest, And we knew that we'd seen all the other grand finals where the first 17 that won through to the grand final outran the other team eventually, And the Eagles, after they settled down, beat the bloody Geelong by running and running. And that's what we thought. If we just keep at them and crack at them, we'll break them eventually. And we got it, and the rain came, and I thought, gee whiz,
seven goals without a miss in that second quarter is fantastic.
Yes, that's what really broke their heart, I think. And but it was a good effort by the Bays.
Congratulations. Go and enjoy yourself,
thanks,
mate.
Thanks very much, Ian, bloody ripper.
Well, 8 out of 9, Greg. 8 premierships out of 9.
Unbelievable, mate.
Well, I've got the hat on, because if you can't beat them, you've got to join them.
Yeah, well, you picked Glenelg, didn't you?
Yeah, I know. That's the first thing you did say to me. Well, that's fantastic. Yeah. What a day.
Oh, mate, tremendous, wasn't it? I lost the toss, and I thought, hell, I hoped that I was going to win it with that breeze, and it's very important that you get away to a few goals, and, we had to settle down and really work hard, and they kicked 3 goals to us, 1, and... then that second quarter, and things started to work with us, and we used the breeze, and a couple of lucky and a couple of good goals, especially that one by Brett Chalmers, just hyped up the players, and I could really feel in my stomach that we could run the legs off of Glenelg and sort of keep going on with it from there.
All week everyone's been saying, oh, Gucci, he's going to be too slow at centre half back. But when time came and the conditions changed, it didn't need pace. It just needed what you've got in here. And, of course, well, that's Port Adelaide all around.
Oh, well, the Lord must have helped me, mate. I prayed for a bit of rain and to bring them all back to my pace. But tremendous team effort, Rick. The boys have just worked so hard. After last year, I keep saying about last year, but we're pretty disappointed to bow out of the finals the way we did. And, to sort of have summer pre-season and summer training and all through the year, then go well, then to lose a couple of games of the minor round, then to reunite together and really ask each other for effort, mate. I couldn't ask any more of the boys. I know Jack's over the moon.
Well, fantastic. Congratulations on your effort today. I won't ask you about next year, because you can go on. There's no question about that. Well done.
Thanks, Rick. Thank you, fellas.
Welcome back to Football Park, and still a pretty happy scene so far as Port Adelaide is concerned. But looking at the Bays, Graham, where do they go to from here? Today was disappointing their second half, wasn't it?
Well, it was, Ken. I mean, I guess the old story about the agony of defeat in the grand final makes you go harder next year. That's all I can say.
Well,
the fact they lost, they may come up next year a lot harder and more difficult to beat.
I wonder how Hodgie feels.
Shattered. Absolutely shattered. Mm. Devastated is the word. Yeah, you do.
I can just imagine. OK, well, let's now go to the women's room once again and see what's happening down there. They're a pretty happy mob, I can tell you.
Over the years, I've really looked forward to playing with you guys. Although, perhaps I know that most people don't.
Shush!
Most people have a healthy respect for Port Adelaide Football Club. Most people probably hate Port Adelaide Football Club. And that's just a sign of how successful you are and what a great club you must be. And I'm very envious of you all. And thanks for a great game.
Obviously, as coach of the Glenelg Footy Club, I was extremely proud of my players. They came from the elimination final and obviously come against one of the toughest teams in South Australian National Football League history, and you're a credit to your club. I'm proud of my players and I'm proud of this bloke alongside of me. Obviously, he's retired today, and I wish him well for the future, but well done to you guys and well done to Jack, and you're a great football club. Well done.
Scotty Salisbury and Kim Hodgman there saying well done to the Port Adelaide players, and that wouldn't be easy, Graham.
Ken, there's a saying in football, you've got to be humble in victory and gracious in defeat. Yep. Weren't they gracious in defeat?
Yes, they certainly
they
were.
They really were. Scotty Salisbury's last game would be hurt by the defeat. Nonetheless, he took it on the chin. He's that sort of a bloke.
He certainly has been a good player for the Bays, hasn't he?
Well, he's a self-made player, Ken.
He is.
Not a lot of skill, let's be honest about that. He plays on his heart, and that's the sort of guy he is, and he's just got there on that.
He certainly has. OK, let's go back to the Port Adelaide dressing rooms once again.
Oh, well, a couple of stars here, Scotty Hodges, and little Georgie Porgy Pudney Pie. Well, boys, congratulations. So, firstly to you, Scotty, after all years, not a lot of football with Port Adelaide, but to come out, you are a lucky devil, aren't you?
Yeah, well, I suppose I was very fortunate to get four games in, and you know, it's just a credit to the blokes. You know, they just worked hard all year, and you know, they really deserve it today. And it's been a long bloody year, you know, and you know, it's good to just finish off the year with premiership, and you know, got to start training in 3 weeks. So it doesn't last long.
And to you, George, a great year, really superb. They said they were too slow, they were too old, and I was one of them. And in the end result, the heart came through.
Yeah, I think so. I think it really told when the rain came down how much desire we had to win that game. And you know, we did it for Greg, we did it for Mark Williams. It's probably their last game. Yeah, and each of us really got driven by the fact that we were so frightened to lose. So it was a great effort.
Now, George, the future.
Yeah,
we got the future here?
There's little Matty, little boy.
And he's all bewildered by it all, but
yeah,
I suppose the foundation, George, is there, isn't it?
Yeah, I've already given a sip of champagne, but I don't think he likes it too much.
And the conditions, Scott, when it came out, it was beautiful sunny conditions, and then all of a sudden it turned nasty. But Port Adelaide, it wouldn't have mattered, would it?
I think it took, you know, about 15 minutes in the second quarter before we started to play footy, and we knew that at that stage that, you know, we were just winding up, and then the rain came and it did make it hard for them. We knew that they were going to tie first, and they did, and we just powered on, and, you know, we had a lot of rest over the last, 5 weeks. We only had 2 games in 5 weeks, so it was a great effort.
Well, to you two blokes, congratulations. Enjoy the night. Don't go too hard, too early, because it's a long old night.
Who'd you pick anyway?
I picked the Bays, and I've joined them. I've joined you. Thanks very much, boys.
It's a bit of a worry down on the Port Adelaide. Two of the old timers sitting together arm in arm. Darren, I hope he's not like that.
Well, I'm glad he was standing Fidgy today, not me, because he did a great job. And I don't mind Roger. He's not a bad bloke, but he's not quite as good looking as my wife.
I think she's just about to spring a child for you.
Yeah, she's got about 2 weeks to go, so it's
worked out
well. Yep, my first.
Hey, a grand final and a son or a daughter, that's marvellous.
Oh, it's going to be a very good couple of months, yes, for sure.
How did you see it today? I mean, when did you really think you had it scun?
Oh, that third quarter proved that, you know, we started playing good football and how we can play, and that's the quarter that won the game.
Roger, you did an uncustomary couple of funny things in that first quarter and kicked across goal and lost it. Did you think, hang on, it's not going to be my day, or have you got confidence?
Yeah, I sort of made a couple of blues. I was just trying to play my normal game, and unfortunately it didn't come off the first couple of kicks I had, but I mean, you just got to keep assisting, and it went all right in the end, so that's all right.
It certainly did on those sort of days when you keep on running. You got to win eventually. Oh, hey, gee, hang on. No, fellas, leave me alone. They always do this. Roger, you and Fidji, I thought in that last quarter when he kicked that goal, did you point to the scoreboard?
No, I didn't point to the scoreboard, actually. I pointed to to Mick Abbott, because I saw Nathan Buckley cop one in the Crown Jewels about a second before that, and I was wondering why he didn't get a free for that. But I never pointed to the scoreboard, mate. I'm not like that.
Nearly ruined his future, Nathan. Yeah. Tell me, what did Jack say at halftime? You went in with a 21-point advantage. Did he feel as though at that stage you had it scun?
No, he didn't. He just basically wanted us to keep quiet, just think about the rest of the half. I mean, first half wasn't bad, but we really wanted to persist and go further in the second half. So he just said, keep quiet, take it in, get your minds right for the third quarter, and that was what we did.
Darren and Roger, all the best, and well done for your kid in a couple of weeks' time, mate.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Dave.
Thanks, guys.
Well, Welcome back to Football Park. It's an absolutely pelts down here, Graeme. I'm glad we're undercover. It is teeming at the moment.
Well, Ken, at half-time, I was supposed to be out on the ground. I said I might get electrocuted, leave me under the tunnel, you know, but finally it did subside.
Now, Graeme, you're a good judge of umpiring. How did you see the umpire's performance today?
Well, Ken, I have no reason to criticise. I just saw a couple of soft free kicks early to Port in front of goal.
Right.
Didn't help the Glenelg cause. It wouldn't have saved the game for them. Like, really, when you think about it, 17 goals through would win anything.
Exactly.
And they kicked the last 9 goals straight, Port. So on top of, I suppose, kicking all those goals, they kicked straight. And it really buried the Bays, and it was just a no contest after halftime.
OK, here's Rick Davies with the 2 men in white.
Well, I'm a lucky guy because I'm down here with the umpires of the day. Fantastic effort, boys. Not often I can say that, but today was great.
Not often you do say that, actually, Jumbo. I'd just like to know what Kim Dillon thought.
Yeah. What about you, Kevin? What did you think? First grand final?
Yeah, it was pretty good, actually. The game was hard and fast to start with, and then the rain came and spoiled it a bit, but both sides went in hard, I think.
What do you think of the conditions, Michael? It started off very, very, sunny, and then all of a sudden it teemed.
Yeah, actually, it just came down in buckets, actually. It came straight down. It was fairly difficult towards the end. It was quite slippery. I noticed the players were slipping around a bit.
Were the instructions to let the play go on a bit? Because obviously that's what... you did it, and did it fantastically.
Yeah, I suppose that's what we've tried to accomplish all year, so that's what we tried to just umpire the same way.
Port Adelaide, I think they're too good, aren't they?
Yeah, they must be. They won. No, they. I think in the time on period of the second quarter, they got a couple of quick goals. And don't pull your pants down.
What about the difference between today and an AFL, just an ordinary game?
Grand final is much more intense. And, grand final is the be end and end all of football. So you can't really compare them.
What about you?
Oh, well, it's just the first time I've experienced those conditions, and it's nothing compared to it.
I want your best player.
I thought Nathan Buckley, but I thought Port Adelaide's half-back line played extremely well. I thought Buckley and Glenelg's McKay.
Yeah,
on
McKay.
Boys, a job well done. Thanks. Congratulations.
Thanks, Jeremy.
Players and I thought they umpired particularly well. Graeme, how did
Isn't that amazing, though, Ken? About those blokes, Paul Bell and the Magarey also, that
yes.
They mentioned. They like those two.
Well, Andrew McKay played a superb game today.
Yes, but think about
the
that. They got all the votes during the season also.
Yeah, they did. And I thought Paul Northeast game today was outstanding.
Oh, yeah. Look, Ken, the thing about Northeast is his man never he does very little.
Yes.
Northeast, I think, is an old-fashioned defender where he cuts his opponent out of the game first and worries about getting kicked second. Top game.
OK, well, let's now go down and to the winner's room once again. And this time we talk to the Ferrisex.
Julie Cale, congratulations. Must be terrific thrill for you and Scotty.
Yeah, it's excellent.
Scotty, 6 goals today. Real highlight for you?
Yeah, he's a champion.
Was he nervous before the game?
No.
So he's pretty relaxed?
Yes.
And what did you do to help him in his preparation?
I just let him do what he wants to do. I stay out his way.
And what about tonight? What are you going to do to help him celebrate?
I'll help him drink.
We've got Leah here, girlfriend of Adrian Setri. Leah, any unusual things that Adrian did before the game?
No, everything as usual.
Okay. And what were you thinking when he came on and kicked that great goal where he bent the ball back with the breeze? It was just a ripper goal and got Port Adelaide going. How did you feel?
Wrapped. Absolutely wrapped.
Now, were you watching Port Adelaide the whole game or were you just watching Adrian?
Well, a bit of both.
Okay, and what's your plans tonight?
Party.
Is it party to your drop?
Yeah.
Now, over here we've got Lorraine, your Paul Rosonico's girlfriend.
Yeah,
is that right? What do you think of Paul's game?
Oh, very good, yeah, played really well.
He was a little bit scratchy early, he did a couple of things wrong. Were you a bit concerned that perhaps things weren't going to roll his way?
Oh, I think the first quarter everybody was a bit nervous, but they all got it together and played a really good team game.
And how would you critique his game?
Oh, very good, yeah, everybody's very good.
Right. So, Julie, just finally, Mum and Dad will all be pretty happy tonight and there'll be plenty of celebrating.
Oh, yeah, we'll be celebrating all week.
Terrific. Well, have a good night and enjoy it.
David McKay gets all the good jobs, Graeme, doesn't he? Eh? Talking to the ladies, he's a lucky man.
Hey, Ken, these girls aren't bad judges, are they? Of football people. Julie said Scotty's a champion, I'll agree with that.
Yes.
And the last girl, can't remember, Port Rosonico's girlfriend, said they all played well, and they did all play well. See, old-fashioned, all played well. You come up with good players, and after Buckley and, I guess, Chalmers and Hodges for 6 goals, and Northeast, as you said, then... Nobody really put in a bad one.
No, great performance by Port Adelaide. Well, if you want a copy, of course, of the Reserves Grand Final, or the big one today, you can go to SA Video Warehouse at 274 Weymouth Street in the city. You can see Tom or Kevin down there, and also Brassis, John Martin, Tara Scarf and Meyer will have a copy for you. But SA Video Warehouse is a place to go on Tuesday if you want a copy of the 1992 Grand Final. Back with more footy shortly.